like to call the November 22nd, 2016 school committee meeting to order. Tonight's meeting is being recorded for RCTV. We are going to start with public comment. Is there anybody here who would like to address the committee on an item that is not on our agenda? Seeing none, consent agenda.
Is there anything anybody would like to remove from the consent agenda? I'd like to move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All those in favor? 5-0, the motion carries. Let's do reports, because I think, Dr. Doherty, are yours long tonight, or do you think they're relatively quick?
I think we can do it. We're waiting for Mr. Joyce anyway, so,
anyway, okay.
So this will be good.
Sounds good. We'll start with the committee. Does anybody on the committee have a report? Yeah, Mrs.
I just want to make sure that people remember that we're showing the Breaking Points video. RUCASA is on November 30th, which is, what day is that? Wednesday, November 30th. Wednesday, because Tuesday is Board of Selectmen.
It is Wednesday, yep.
I believe at 7 o'clock here in the Performing Arts Center, and it will be a film screening, and then there'll be a panel discussion by some professionals in the sort of substance abuse area, and I believe Julianne on RUCASA, a couple of other people. So I highly recommend it for parents and for our young people in the community to come out and see that.
Yeah, Mr. Robinson.
So not a liaison report, maybe more of an editorial report, but I think it's worth saying Dr. Doxter, Ms. Borowski, and Dr. Doherty and I were in, and Adam was there at the football luncheon today, and I was so very proud of our boys. And the Stoneham boys too, mm-hmm. and the way they spoke, and you know, I've been to a lot of those, and mm-hmm. every year they seem to get better, and the boys just had, they came prepared with something they wanted to talk about, and I just thought that was just very well done.
Totally agree.
Two things. One was about the RUCASA event. Last time at the annual meeting, there was a discussion that started about the anxiety, and there was some discussion about the school's roles in that. So I was just going to suggest that it might be great if people on the school committee are available to try to go to that event too, so that we have some of us that are there. I know I'm going to be splitting my time, which segues into my other report. Actually, like Ms. Wilson will be reporting on it. I will be going to the CPAC meeting that night, as well as the RUCASA meeting. But I just wanted to say it would be great if we had some school committee members there, if at all possible, mm-hmm. to join that conversation. I believe Dr. Doherty is going to do the first part of another report that I just wanted to put an addendum on. So. I'll wait until Dr. Doherty. Are you going to report on the Art for the Sky?
No.
At Killam? Oh, all right. So I was just going to say that there was a special program at JW Killam that was organized by Amy Burgoyne and a team of teachers, and funded by a bunch of different, by an REF grant, by Sherman Crane in Wilmington, Home Depot in Danvers and Reading, Northeast Nursery, Mike, the owner of Renewal Landscaping in Reading, and it was a wonderful program where, and the name of the artist escapes me, which is really
Dan.
Was, I don't have it written
there was
down.
A great article in the Chronicle on
yes.
this.
Yes, yes.
Where the
and in the Journey, yep.
yes, where, yes, where the kids were led to be able to see the environment from different perspectives, and each other from different perspectives, and he really mixed the core value lessons and environmental awareness and environment and awareness of those around the kids with a concrete project of creating art that was looked very different from another perspective, in this case from a crane looking down, and that's the picture that was in the Chronicle and in the Journey where they made their mascot the koala, and everyone in the school was an important part of that piece of art. But I just wanted to say it was wonderful that that was able to happen. Thank you to all the funders and to Amy Burgoyne and music teacher Holly Gallant, who impressed the artist with the music that the kids were able to learn that was related, that will stay in their heads and their hearts for a very, very long time, I think. I was really honored to be able to be there. Thank you.
Anything else from the committee? Well, I should say that town meeting wrapped up. We do have a special town meeting scheduled for December 8th. But the regular town meeting wrapped up this week, and Dr. Doherty did a very nice job with the state of the school. So on behalf of the committee, thank you for that. It was a real celebration of what our teachers do every day and some very exceptional students as well. So I think I heard very positive feedback from the community that they were glad to get that very personal account of what we see regularly because of what we do. But sometimes people who don't have kids in the system don't get a chance to see the incredible work that's happening in the schools. And in fact, today, I actually met a parent in the community who was talking about just that, about just how much his children have gotten from attending Reading Public Schools. So there's a lot of great things happening. It was a good celebration of that.
I just wanted to add that I really appreciated the Dr. Doherty's address. Actually, your address was excellent for the state of the schools. And I think for the one time a year at town meeting that we get to, you know, report on the state of the schools, it is nice to be able to take a little bit of extra time. And Dr. Doherty uses that to present the superintendent's awards to a female and male high school student. And that was just amazing to hear about their accomplishments. And they always recognize a couple of teachers that support them and or that have been instrumental in their education. But I wanted to say that I really appreciated how you changed up the presentation. I think that's the kind of thing people are looking for in terms of something that you can connect to personally and something that's sort of in the visual and technology modes that we are used to today. So I really appreciate that.
Thank you, it was excellent. Speaking of our students, what's going on at RMHS?
So we have a pep rally tomorrow. It starts around 10 o'clock, I believe. And that's usually really fun. Also, the drama club presented The Wedding Singer last weekend and the weekend before. It was also Grumman. It was awesome. Also, there is an informal recital on December 1st after school. Musicians, so either instrumentalists or vocalists, will be performing after school that day, and I encourage anybody to come. Also, a bunch of students from high school recently auditioned for senior districts. And I heard a lot of them nodded, which is awesome. And lastly, girls swim. They are the state champions.
Woo-hoo! Awesome.
Okay, was their record just one loss out to Acton? It was not a league meet. Just I think it was just that one. They did awesome. That was amazing. Unbelievable record.
As you probably know, the football team has two games coming up. So they have Thursday's Thanksgiving game against Storm, and then they're playing in the Division II Super Bowl this weekend against King Philip. So,
yes.
So
not this weekend, next weekend,
next
right?
Weekend.
Yeah.
And there was a shelter in place drill today at the school, and I nothing I heard.
I have a feeling Dr. Doherty is going to be giving us an update on that
sure.
in a little bit. Thank you so much. I should say I saw The Wedding Singer last weekend, and it was so good. That our drama program never fails to amaze. Thank you both for that. Dr. Doherty.
Do you have any?
No, I do not.
You want me to do my update?
Okay.
Sure.
So just a couple things. Last Thursday, Dr. Doherty, Mr. Blaustein, and Mrs. Lassise and I attended a Thanksgiving celebration at the POST program. It was a wonderful opportunity to see some of the students, to see the space. The students prepared the meal. They decorated their space. They were greeters and welcomed us into their space. What was really nice was an opportunity for us to connect with students who were there, and we actually had a student who had graduated last January, and he came back to be with his peers for this celebration, so that was really nice. The space looks fantastic. They now have a couch. They have a large screen TV, so they have a recreational space. They have a functional kitchen, and they have a washer and dryer as well. So the students are able to work on life skills, and a couple of students we spoke to were telling us about the job opportunities we have. We have a student who is working at the hospital, and another student who's over at the Wakefield Library doing some work there as an intern as well. So that was exciting. Last Thursday, I also hosted with Mr. Sprung and Ms. Benjamin, who's the new team chair at Joshua Eaton. We had a listening session with the parents who are in the Bridge program at Joshua Eaton. There had been a lot of interest in just being able to share strengths and weaknesses, so we hosted that Thursday morning and had some parents come out and share what their experiences are, and now we can kind of move forward and kind of make some decisions from that information, but we hosted that last week. And the next CPAC meeting is next Wednesday, the 30th. Dr. Olivardia, who is a parent in the community, is going to be speaking about ADHD and dyslexia, and that will be at the Reading Public Library at 7 o'clock. Thank you.
Just an observation, because we've heard a lot of great things. As we all know, November, from a school perspective, is a very short month, because you have two holidays. You have Veterans Day, you have Thanksgiving. Conference Day is another. And Election Day this year we also had as a professional day. But you hear all of the great things that are happening in our schools between the Art in the Sky, which happened earlier in the month, the football, the swim team winning the Division II state championship, and all of the other different activities that are happening, the post program. I mean, these are all great things that are happening in our schools on a regular basis, and it is a tribute to our, and it's kind of what I was saying at the State of the Schools, it is a tribute to the students that we have and the staff, the dedication of the staff, and the impact that they have each and every day on our kids. So even though November was a short month, a lot was going on, a lot of positive things were going on. Today, as Mario said, making a transition, we did something that we have done on two other occasions. This was the third time that we have had, in the last few years, a shelter-in-place / canine search. It's something that the school committee has a policy that was put in place a few years ago, and we've worked in cooperation with the Reading Police Department and with the Middlesex Sheriff's Office, who provides the canines for the search. And obviously, our number one priority is the safety and well-being of our students. And this is one of the activities that we do to help with that. And today, we had a shelter in place about 9:10 a.m. is when it started. In collaboration with the police department, the sheriff's office had 16 canines came. And the way that it works, just for people that don't know, when you go in a shelter in place, normal activities can be going on in the classroom. It is not a lockdown. The announcement is made when that happens. And there are randomly chosen classrooms by the police department where we have the students, an administrator goes in, tells the students that we're going to be doing a canine search. The students leave the classroom, and then the canine comes in and does a search, and then the canine leaves, unless they do sense something, and then a second canine is brought in for a verification. That's also done in all the common spaces, the locker rooms, the hallways, and so that process happens for several minutes. In addition, after the search is done inside, there's also a search done in the parking lots outside. So the activity was led by Officer Mulo. He was the commander for the situation, the drill that we had today. We did have, as I communicated to the community this afternoon, we had what called four alerts. Two were out in the parking lot and two were inside. What an alert is that the canine senses that there is something in the location. A second dog is brought in to verify that. Then the administrator, as part of the protocol, searches the area that has been verified by the second canine. In all four instances, searches were done and there was no evidence of any narcotics or anything like that. So, and then the whole situation took about 55 minutes for it to occur.
John, I know in the past when we've done this, today was a very windy day. Does that affect?
No, it wasn't that windy here. Yeah, no, it wasn't. It wasn't windy. It was pretty nice out during the actual search. But you're right. When it's windy, you cannot do the search outside.
Okay.
That is correct.
It's windy everywhere else.
Yeah, it wasn't bad here.
How many dogs were there?
16.
The
I also want to add that the high school administration, for a lot of the people involved today, it was their first time here doing it, and Mr. Barker, along with the rest of the high school administration, and Officer Mulo in the police department, did an outstanding job.
In your email, you had said that this is something that's done in other neighboring communities as well. So
it is a common
community
activity,
yeah,
that's done in other districts. So that's my report.
Yep, this is one other quick thing. I just wanted to thank Linda's taking the lead on the Festival of Trees, helping to organize that for us. And the Festival of Trees is coming up the weekend of December 4th and 5th. It's the Saturday and the Sunday.
Yep.
And the setup, they were going for 100 trees. The last email I saw.
They need more.
They still need a few more trees to hit the 100. So if any of the organizations in the community, in the schools, or the community at large are still interested, they're still trying to get to that 100. But I just wanted to thank Linda. We have, I think, a good plan.
Thank you, Linda. Absolutely. And it is December 3rd and 4th at Parker Middle School, and it is a fantastic event. Really fun.
I also, Mr. Dancer, I can't come up with his first name, but that's the artist who did the art for the sky. I apologize, it didn't come to me at first. And also, I wanted to let people know, I've gotten some inquiries about the Human Relations Advisory Committee, and our meeting in December will be on the 6th, which is a Tuesday, and we'll be meeting at the town hall in the conference room. Usually it's at on the Thursday, but this coming month, for reason of conflicts, we'll be meeting on this December 6th at town hall. And everybody is welcome and encouraged to come, please.
So Mr. Joyce isn't here.
He is here.
Mr. Joyce.
Mr. Joyce.
You snuck in.
Come on up.
Thanks for being here tonight.
Thank you so much for having me. My name is Michael Joyce. I am your attorney. For certain purposes.
Not words we typically like to hear.
Exactly. So I just want to say at the beginning, it is my absolute pleasure to be here. It is a pleasure to work with Dr. Daugherty, Assistant Superintendent Martin, and Ms. Wilson, as well as Mr. Barker. I've been representing Reading for at least 5 or 6 years. Myself personally, my firm has been working with Reading longer than that. The administration is honestly a pleasure to work with. I was asked to speak to you today a little bit about kind of the special education process as it relates to settlement agreements. I'm of course happy to answer any questions as we go. I think the best place to start, particularly when we're talking about special education, just so you understand my role. So I represent the school district on essentially non-labor and non-employment matters. So things relating to, we do a lot of work on civil rights harassment around bullying issues, disciplinary issues, homelessness, residency, right, as well as special education, a substantial portion because of the litigation associated with it, as well as the complication of the regulations. It's extremely complex, small but complex area of law. When we talk about students who are covered under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, more commonly known as kids on IEPs, the standard that we're obligated to provide for those eligible students is a free and appropriate public education. What that means for kids on IEPs is that we're required to provide special education, specially designed instruction that could be modified work, modified classrooms, modified methodologies of instruction, and or related services, speech language, reading services, occupational therapy services to students. And the standard is reasonably calculated to make effective progress commensurate with his or her abilities. So that's the standard that we're held to as we develop the IEP, right? So we're developing IEPs annually, so it's what's known as a snapshot, right? So at that time you're developing it, is it reasonably calculated? Obviously, no one has a crystal ball to predict exactly how things are going to go, but did we make the right steps to have the student make effective progress? When the parents have the opportunity when we propose in an IEP team. The IEP team is really the governing body of the IEP. They're the ones who modify the IEP, propose changes, propose the initial IEP, propose eligibility. When the IEP team proposes a new IEP, the parents have the opportunity to do several things with that. Number one, they can accept it in full and consent to the placement. So it's IEP services, and then the placement runs a continuum of options. So you're talking about full inclusion placement, right? Meaning that students are educated with general education students the vast majority of the school day. Partial inclusion, which means they're receiving pull-out services outside of the general education setting. Substantially separate, which is receiving the majority of their services outside of the general education setting, but they're still included with the typical peers during periods of time throughout the day. And then you're talking about out-of-district placement. One of the reasons that's critically important in the context of FAPE is what the IDEA requires is that we educate students with non-disabled students to the maximum extent appropriate. If you look at the history of the IDEA when it was passed in 1975, millions of students were being warehoused, literally warehoused outside of the general education population. So the call of the IDEA initially was to mainstream kids, right? So when we're looking at that standard I articulated earlier, reasonably calculated to make effective progress in the least restrictive environment, meaning again, to the maximum extent appropriate to non-disabled peers. So in an ideal construct, we're trying full inclusion, then partial inclusion, then substantially separate, and then we might consider a more restrictive setting, which is an out-of-district placement. That could be a public collaborative placement, public day school, or private placement. Those are restrictive because there are no, typically in these cases, no non-disabled students. They're in a segregated population. More restrictive of that, of course, would be residential placement. More restrictive would be a pediatric hospital, and then in the home would be the most restrictive setting. So when the parents, so when we propose that IEP and we propose a placement, the parents can accept the IEP, accept the placement. They can partially accept, meaning, hey, we're going to agree to allow you to implement services X, Y, and Z, but we're going to reject your proposal as to, let's say, a reduction of service or an increase in service. Make sense? Or they can completely reject the IEP. Our obligation at that point is to to implement what's called the stay put IEP. So we are not allowed to implement it if the parents didn't accept it, right? So we implement the last accepted IEP. So for instance, let's say we're up for an annual review, the student had an existing IEP in one of our substantially separate programs. We convene the team, we propose a new IEP in a different setting. Parents reject it, that student continues in that substantially separate program because it's the last accepted IEP. Whenever an IEP is rejected, we're required to send notice to the Bureau of Special Education Appeals. That's the administrative law judges, essentially, the administrative body that hears disputes over special education. It is a state entity. It's mandated by the IDEA that we have this state entity. Essentially, it's a hearing officer, right? But we send notice of the rejection. The parents have the opportunity to file for hearing against the school district claiming that we did not provide the student with a free appropriate public education. Now, prior to that, We have other opportunities. We have an opportunity for mediation. If parents want to seek, we're willing. It's voluntary on part of both parties. There's a number of mediations, and I'd say the mediations typically 94%, I believe, from fiscal year 2015 result in some sort of an agreement between the district and the parties. And I think it's important that mediation process, because ultimately we are seeking a collaborative process. That is the call of the IDEA. But obviously sometimes it's disagreements. The district thinks, hey, we think we're providing a free, appropriate public education in a least restrictive environment. And the parents might say, you know what, we want something different. We believe that our child is entitled to it under the law. Parents can also, either by themselves or with the assistance of an attorney, most commonly with the assistance of an attorney, file for hearing before the Bureau of Special Education Appeals. It is an extremely formal process. There's an intensive discovery process on behalf of both parties. Their hearings typically last between 2 to 4 days, whereas if the parents were filing, they would have the burden of proof to show that we were not providing a free, appropriate public education in a least restrictive environment. and we would put on our case. It's subject to cross-examination, witnesses. Typically, there's expert witnesses. It might be our educators, psychologists, occupational therapists testifying. They might have outside providers testifying. Ultimately, the hearing officer is going to write typically somewhere between a 20 and 40 page decision on the merits of the case. Those are public documents when it is published, and typically I'd say over 95% of the school district is named in those cases when they are published online. Last year, fiscal year 2015, there were 492 requests for hearing filed across the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. 18 went to hearing. So that begs the question, what happened to the rest of them? Mm-hmm. Now we get to settlement agreements. So most of these cases resolve prior to hearing. The IDEA specifically carved out the opportunity for parents and school districts to engage in written settlement agreements in order to resolve disputes. Now, settlement agreements don't need a hearing request to happen, right? Sometimes things are brought to our attention. We certainly, myself and Carolyn particularly, working together, try to pride ourselves on getting ahead of issues. Okay, there's something circulating. Let's get it to me. Let me review it. Let's assess the case, because frankly, we'd rather not spend the money on litigation if we could direct that towards a student. And that is the view that we both take in working together on these cases. One thing in the context as I begin to discuss settlement agreements, I think it's critically important. You need to understand what happens if we lose at the Bureau of Special Education Appeals. If we lose at the Bureau of Special Education Appeals, we've now pulled multiple members of our personnel away from students for a 2 or 3 day period. They're typically present throughout the process. We've accrued costs, attorney's fees, preparation. Typically, I would come out. We haven't gotten to this stage where we've been on the eve of hearing. I would come out at least 2 or 3 times to prepare witnesses for hearing. If after a decision on the merits we lose, we pay the other side's attorney's fees. Right? Doesn't matter whether it was a close call. Doesn't matter whether I thought we had a good case, whether I thought we presented the best case on earth. Right? Doesn't matter if they really liked us. If we lose, we pay the other side's attorney's fees. The approximate cost for a BSEA hearing case for the parent side attorney's fees would be fairly estimated between $40,000 and $70,000. It would depend on the rate of the attorney, but because the attorney's fees claims would go to court typically, federal court is where it would be resolved and you're still accruing fees at that time. They don't necessarily have to award what they charge the parents. They can award in excess what they believe a reasonable fee could be. So often that rate can rise to a level somewhere between $250 to $375 an hour for the attorney. So the reason that's important, you might say, why do we settle cases, right? And what goes into the settlement? Yes, please.
If we were to win, do they pay for all the lost time for the teachers and the classroom and our attorneys, or no?
No, they do not. The only way we can claim attorney's fees from the parents or the parents' attorney is if they file a frivolous case, Right.
If it was determined by the judge or that it was.
Yeah, ultimately, correct. So ultimately, we'd have to go to federal court to enforce that, right, in terms of a determination as to frivolousness. Examples of frivolousness might be we offered to settle the case for why, their claim was why, and they proceeded anyway, right? Frivolous is a pretty high legal standard to meet. It's only going to apply to a minority of cases. I would say that most parents are bringing cases for legitimate reasons. We might disagree with their position, but they're parents of individuals with disabilities who they care deeply about and are passionate about their educational programming. And I think that kind of tone of respect is something, even in adversarial nature of a BSEA process, that we try to engage in the level of collegiality that we can, given the adversarial nature of the circumstances. So when you're talking about what goes into settlement, so what we're looking at is on the individual merits of each case. So what happened last week with a different child on a different case is not really relevant to how we're looking at this case. What constitutes FAPE is a couple of things. I mentioned that standard effective progress. Clearly, our evaluations, our documentation, our IEP progress reports all need to demonstrate that we've met our burden, that we have engaged or proposed IEPs that were reasonably calculated, and when they were working, they were documented, and when they weren't working, we changed or modified what we were proposing in order to meet the students' needs as the students' needs change, right? And that often happens in the course of a student's career. Procedural errors are significant. Parents and students have significant rights under the IDEA. And if there are significant procedural flaws within our case upon my review or Ms. Wilson's review, then that might be a reason that we might not want to go to hearing. It affects our case several ways, both substantively, because a procedural violation can deny a student FAPE in itself, but it can undermine our credibility. So it's as witnesses. If the hearing officer sees that we didn't follow the procedural requirements, well, we're not going to look credible at hearing. That's something that why we try to work towards and do trainings on compliance in that direction. The other factor, of course, is how is the student doing within our programs, right? Is our program appropriate? One of the things that we offer, as I mentioned at the onset, is that we offer non-disabled peers. That's something that we offer that no private special education school can offer. It's a more segregated environment as described under the law. So when we're looking at a case, the parents are typically, right, the cases that involving settlement agreements for out-of-district placements. We're talking the parents have either unilaterally placed, said, I'm placing my student at the out-of-district, my child at the out-of-district placement, and now I'm filing a claim, the student's already there, or the student's still within our school system and they're seeking to place the student out. Because of the factor of a couple things, we're looking at, in settlement, a few things. I would say number one, cost certainty, right? So when I talked about the risk of going to hearing, the paying the attorney's fees, the stay put would apply to that, so the student could be continuing on at cost to the district. Not only for the, don't forget, the cost of the tuition, but it's also the cost of the transportation as well, which is a significant factor. Because that's generally non-reimbursable, unlike the cost of the out-of-district placement, which is reimbursable after a certain amount from the state. You're talking about risk mitigation, and this goes for both sides, for the parents as well as the district. You don't know what a hearing officer is going to do. Just like any court, any judge, any administrative process. And you don't know how the evidence is going to come in. You could have cases that look great on paper, but after doing witness prep, you consult with one another, you see how the witness might present with the lawyer that's on their side, and you may make a decision based on that. There are many factors that go into settlement, and I think the way the system is designed, both sides are incentivized to reach settlement, which is why you see those numbers across the Commonwealth, 492 filed, 18 went to hearing. Dramatic, pretty dramatic numbers. Now those settlements run the gamut depending on the individual merits of the case and the terms on which any school committee, not limited to Reading, and just so you're aware, my office represents about 60 public school districts in Massachusetts on these issues. So when I'm speaking, I want to be clear, I'm speaking broadly, not about exclusively about Reading cases. You're talking about any constellation, you're going to see a wide variety of settlements. Why? The merits. Where are we relative to making effective progress? Where are we on our procedures, right? That's going to beget different outcomes in terms of settling cases. Often the settlement agreements, when I talk about cost certainty, are going to go over the course of years. So we have predictive costs that go along with that. And oftentimes we're able to mitigate our costs through that. So for instance, we know we have a risk of full payment of that out-of-district placement, potentially attorney's fees, potentially transportation. But let's say we reach a settlement where, you know, we're willing to pay the tuition, but the parents agree to transport themselves. Well, that might be a $25,000 cost saving to the district in that particular case as a result of settlement. On the other side, the parents have been incentivized to settle. Why? Because they want that particular placement. So for instance, there are other cases that come up, such as we have already placed the student in a private out-of-district placement, but the parents prefer another one. And so the parents are incentivized to settle because they're not necessarily entitled to the preferred placement, right? But they want us to fund that. So that would be another cause to engage, let's say, a settlement agreement, even though we've agreed that the student belongs outside of the mainstream setting. One of the things that I definitely want to talk about is that has been impacted recently. Last fall, there was a decision by the Supreme Judicial Court called Champa v. Weston Schools. This made the settlement agreements public, right? So what, to a surprise of many people, including parent side groups and parent side attorneys, as well as people who represent school districts like myself, there was a request that came forward for all the settlement agreements from the school district. The way the Supreme Judicial Court ruled on it said, hey, look, that is a student record. Those settlement agreements are the records, student records, just like other educational records. Under both FERPA, Family Educational Rights Privacy Act, that's federal law, as well as state law, those are protected. Those are confidential. However, what they said is you can de-identify those. So you can remove personally identifiable information from those settlement agreements that would allow someone in the school community who knew the student to identify them, right, but not familiar with the particular facts of the case. You can remove that, you can redact that from the agreement. And once you do that, they become public records and you're entitled to those. So that's what's been happening. There are many requests. We've received at least two, I believe. Mm-hmm. Three. Public records requests for settlement agreements, which have gone through the process. We've redacted the personally identifiable information, which is critically important to us because this is the identifiable information of minor disabled children. We take that very seriously before we reveal, and I've actually got an occasion to review to ensure that we are compliant with that. And we have provided those and consistent with the Supreme Judicial Court decision.
So the cost of redacting is borne by us?
The cost of redacting is that under current law, which is only going to be current for another 5 weeks, we have provided an estimate fee of the cost of redaction, as well as so search and segregation, which includes redaction. But we are only allowed to charge the lowest rate of the lowest paid employee capable of performing such work. So for instance, if Ms. Wilson is the one who actually does the work, which in this case, because we're very concerned about the information that could be revealed, I believe she was the one who did it, we can't charge her rate. We have to charge the lowest person capable of doing it. And essentially, and you'll see in a second when I talk about the new law, they've deemed that to be the cost of an administrative assistant. The law is about to change. Would you like me to go through that, or do you have another question before I go there?
Party who the students with get to review the redacted, you know, proof the redacted record, or is it solely with us? So, I mean, we're trying our very best, right, to comply with the law, to protect the student. I'm just wondering, do they, is that part of it, or it's solely?
So if I'm understanding your question correctly, just make sure I do. So let's say a person from another town, let's call him Harry. Harry has asked for the settlement agreement. So we're providing the settlement agreement of Mrs. Smith's daughter, right? Your question is, does Mrs. Smith get notified?
And does she get to see if we've done a good job in her opinion?
Right. The short answer is she does not, unless she made her own public records request to see if we had, right? So we are charged with that responsibility. There is no right of the individual parent of that student to review our redactions. I would say it would be extremely difficult for us to comply with the timelines that we're required to do if we tried to create that opportunity. They're pretty rigid timelines, and they're going to be more rigid going forward.
So I know we had the Walker report, mm-hmm. and I'm not sure what, who is that, a private entity?
Yes.
So does your firm or others like yours do, I mean, we're forever hearing about all the paperwork that has to be done, and you know, we don't always have the people to get it done or to get it mm-hmm. done in a timely. Is there any risk management audits that are done periodically, or was that what the Walker report was? Or
Well, we don't
to make
engage.
Sure we're not yeah. leaving ourselves open to something down the road, because
we don't engage in the risk management aspect. There certainly are consultant agencies that do provide such a service. One of the things we do, and I really do feel very fortunate to have worked with this administration, is when there are new laws, we work very hard to work together collaboratively to get forms ready, to get procedures ready, and to get them in place as quickly as possible, so that not only the central administration, but the building administration staff can be successful with that. But we don't do the upfront work to try to create forms, procedures, guidelines, etc., to help ensure compliance. And as they can attest to, we do a lot of training with the administrative staff to try to make sure their questions are answered in as much as we can in order to put them in a position to be successful. One thing I would like to mention to follow up on your question, the public records law is changing as of January 1st, 2017. If you've heard about it, great. If you hadn't, I definitely would advise you get some information on it, because it is a significant change upon a public records request. Number one, we have to have a records access officer appointed to the school. There is no additional funding that comes with this particular change in the law.
Oh, surprising.
Of course.
That's new, huh?
What does that mean exactly?
The records access officer is the person who is appointed by the district to field inquiries and requests for public records. There's a whole list of responsibilities under the proposed regulations, so it's November 22nd, the proposed regulations have not been finalized as of this stage, but we are, when they finalize the regulations, which we don't know what they'll look like yet, we will be required to implement them on January 1st. Has several responsibilities, including handling the public records requests, which in frankly understanding the law and that aspect of redacting personally identifiable information, ensuring that that's done in an adequate manner. We will have to respond within 10 days to any request for public records. It is 10 business days, right? And business days is going to correlate to when we're open, according to the proposed regulations. That point, we do provide an estimated fee, right? Because we are over a population, last census, I believe, was 24,000 in Reading, right? We actually can charge for the initial 2 hours, right, of labor. Again, at the lowest hourly rate of a person capable of performing the work, and no more than $25 an hour. We have to provide an estimate, and if we're saying, hey, look, we're not providing information because we think this would constitute a student records violation, or for example, let's say they ask for a public records request of that settlement agreement you engaged in regarding a Killam School student in third grade last week. Well, that would be a targeted request. We know that we have a reasonable basis to believe they know the identity of the record they're seeking, so we would deny that. We'd have to list and explain the exceptions that we're citing to for that. If we don't do that by the 10th business day and give the estimated fee, we waive all fees. Can't charge any fees for that if we don't get it by the 10th business day. Additionally, then we then have to provide the records, right, upon payment of the estimated fee. If we choose to charge, there is basis for waiver that we can consider. We have 25 working days to provide the records. We can request for them to narrow the search. We can engage in some process on that. The thing that is significantly different about the new process is that if we, let's say, err on the side of trying to protect student information, but the supervisor records say, you know what, the parents appealed the supervisor records, that's in the state secretary of state's office, you got it wrong. They can sue us in court and we would have to pay attorney's fees, right, if we didn't settle the case beforehand. There's also potential fines of up to $5,000 for that. So the public records law has gone from being frankly relatively weak in terms of the enforcement capability to very strong in terms of the enforcement capability, but something in the context of these settlement agreements of which I think it's significant to be aware.
Yes,
so
Mr. Robbins.
I just had a follow-up question to Ms. Webb. So the example used, Harry requests information, so wouldn't it make sense to pick up the phone and call whoever that party is and say, you know, someone's requested your son or daughter's information and we're going to provide that to you as well at that point in time so that something doesn't come out in the courts down the road where we're in worse shape with that, with those parents than we would have been if we were up front with.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that you certainly could engage in, and I've certainly done in the context of a BSEA hearing when other kids' IEPs have been ordered provided. I think that you have to keep in mind if you chose to adopt such a practice or policy within the district that these requests can be extremely broad, right? That you could be talking about 50, 60 students based on a request that you're going through that process. And the parents have no remedy, right? Those parents that you're notifying of a disclosure, but you're notifying them of a disclosure of a public record because you've done your job, right? You've de-identified those so that they are not personally identifiable. Let me explain that a little bit, what the personally identifiable information means. It's not only names, date of birth, it's information that would be linkable to another person in the school community who is not familiar with the particular facts of the case. So let's say we have, for some reason, a disability named in the settlement agreement, which would be atypical. You typically wouldn't have that, but let's say you did. And it was something like Angelman syndrome, which is a very relatively rare disability. Well, that would probably make that student identifiable. Or let's say it identifies the school and identifies the student as having a mobility impairment. That would make the student identifiable, right? So you would remove and redact that information. Or another example, let's say we might have 10, 12 students at one particular placement. So that probably, we wouldn't redact that because that information of itself wouldn't make the student personally identifiable. But we have one student at this one placement. And if somebody is able from the community to make the connection between that student and the placement and we left that information in, that would make them identifiable. So we kind of go through that process. I guess the only concern in kind of considering whether or not you'd want to adopt such a practice would be adding to already significant burdens in terms of responding and processing these in the context of limited resource availability already. But that would be your decision, certainly not mine.
So can you just clarify if we provide the information and we've redacted to protect and we've done the best, most responsible job that we could, and it's received by the requester, and the requester isn't happy because they can't find out what they want because it's redacted, I guess.
Sure.
Let's just say that. They can sue us, so bring that to court.
Yep. They can, and it doesn't, they have a remedy to appeal to the supervisor records, which within 90 days, right, which is the Secretary of State's office. They can do that, and that doesn't, generally, that would just form, they would write an opinion as to whether or not we complied with the public record statute. Under the current regulations, there's no exhaustion requirement, so it doesn't appear that they have to go through that process prior to filing for court. But the way it's currently phrased is it would have to be as a result of a court decision. So there would be opportunities for settlement of that particular issue beforehand that wouldn't result in the payment of attorney's fees, mm-hmm. right? On that issue, potentially. So that certainly would relook at what our response was, consider some of the factors I talked about earlier. Is this worth it? But certainly if we felt it was the protection of confidential information that would reveal the identity, it would be tough to take an alternative position to that.
Do you have more?
I don't have any more. Do you have any questions?
Oh, Gary has a question.
I guess the question I have is, hopefully I didn't misunderstand it, but this 10 days that we have to provide them a cost of what our public information officer is going to have to,
yep.
And what if, and then 25 days to provide them the information. Mm-hmm. So what if we give them, you know, an estimate and it's not accurate, you know, either way?
Sure, I think that they have the right to appeal that estimate to the supervisor of records, right, in order to contest the accuracy of that estimate. And part of looking at the search and segregation of it, it's going to depend how we maintain the records, certainly. If those records are easily accessible in electronic form, the searching of it is not going to take that long. However, we get public records requests going back to 2001. So now if we have to go down into the dungeons of the Reading Public Schools, wherever those records may be held, and we have to search those files to find that cost may be more substantial, right? But certainly they have the opportunity to appeal that. I think that my view of it is that we want to engage in reasonable estimates that reflect the actual cost of production. And that's really the way the law says. How much will it cost us to do that? Now that cost estimate could go up, right? After you get in, you start responding to it, and the law certainly contemplates that. The law presumes that the requester is asking by electronic form. Under the proposed regulations, if they're asking for copies, we can only charge 5 cents per copy. That was a modification to the existing law in February, and they adopted that in the new law. We can, under the proposed regulations, charge for the cost of a storage device, like a USB drive as well. But the costs are relatively limited in terms of, clearly the call of the law was transparency in trying to create accessibility to these documents. But it's hard to say, and I would couch everything I'm saying in the fact that the regulations that I'm speaking to, some of what I'm referencing is in the statute, a lot of what I'm referencing is in the proposed regulations, which are not yet final.
And we'll just follow up. So the supervisor of records, that his time or her time is also considered in the estimate?
Let me say, no, so the supervisor records, let me clear, the records access officer, and these are now all becoming terms of art, right? The records access officer is an employee of the district. The supervisor of records is an employee of the Secretary of State.
Oh, okay.
So that's the appellate entity. So they have some nice in the proposed regulations how none of these rules really apply to that entity as they apply to us, right? So they have more time to respond, et cetera, for the most part. And and to provide a response to the appeal, let's say the estimated fee, or our stating that there's an exclusion to the public records that we're citing to for reason of denial of the records. All those things are appealable to the supervisor, the Secretary of State's office.
So what I'm wondering, you said it was 492 and only 18 make it. So in the town of Reading, given where we're at, mm-hmm. Are we looking at hiring another staff person at how much time, and are there consultants now that are doing this? But it seems to me there'd be confidentiality issues, so.
Yeah, so the.
Actually, it's the people that are in this seated here that.
Right, that's the impression I'm getting.
Sure. Certainly any district would have the ability to hire someone, or if you contract with someone for any discrete purpose, they become authorized school personnel, right? Because they're contracting with this agency, so we pass that confidentiality on to them. That being said, I think the vast majority of school districts are going to respond with adding responsibilities to existing personnel. And I think that I don't think that I have enough knowledge and experience to put an FTE, a full-time equivalent, on what that would do. I would think someone from your accounting office might be able to do that, but I think it is significant, potentially, because
a massive accounting.
I mean, you know, you get five of these in 1 week for different requests. That's going to take some significant time responding to those, and you are citing to legal exceptions as you're trying to protect. You're trying to provide the public aspects of those records, but protect the confidential aspects. Creates a pretty time-intensive process where I would certainly be advising and have advised the administration to follow this advice to have multiple layers of review to ensure that confidential information is not improperly disclosed or inadvertently disclosed.
I think it's also important to note that on top of this type of request, we receive a lot of requests for student records from parents or former students to produce their student records, so that's also something that we do a lot of in my office, is copying of just their records for students who may be in college or are now on in their life in employment, or current families who would like a copy of their record. So this type of work, it's not limited to sort of public records requests. We also have other record requests.
I have actually a question that I think you were getting at it, Dr. Doxer, but I think it's a question more for Dr. Doherty. Where are you at with this team in terms of identifying a person who would have this responsibility?
It's basically, most of the requests come to me.
Okay.
And if it's a special education related request, then it's Carolyn and I that are working on it.
I know you know the budget better than anyone. But I will say it's something that we should keep an eye on. Honestly, we have to keep an eye on it. This falls under a mandate, and we have to keep an eye on how much time is being spent on it.
Yeah, I have a couple specific questions, but I'm so beyond keeping an eye on it. I'm just terribly depressed. We should not attack the messenger.
I do not create the laws. I just tell you what they are.
So this is federal law that is enacted then? Or state?
No, this is state law. No. So this is the public records
public
law. The statute, it's MGLC 66, Section 10, right? The exceptions are in Section 26, and they're lettered A through N. They amended this statute, right? In the regulations, right, that are proposed, I believe, are 603 CMR 32.0, which are state regulations, and that will be what they'll be codified at. So this is state law regarding public records.
So I guess I sort of was wondering, do you see that if that Reading is at any sort of greater risk for, records requests? And sort of being engaged in settlement activities than other districts, or?
I don't think they are. If we're looking at the requests we received a number of requests from researchers that have gone out to almost all the districts in the Commonwealth. Certain special education groups have requested all from almost all the districts in the Commonwealth. I think, you know, with your population, the education level of your population, the knowledge level of the population, might you get some more, perhaps. But I don't think that Reading Public Schools is at any more particular risk of having greater requests than other districts, generally speaking.
So, from your perspective and experience, do you feel like sort of the settlement profile, legal profile of special education, or the perception of that in
yeah.
the community, impacts enrollment in a district? Or
I mean, generally, and I don't know Reading Public Schools' numbers, anywhere from 17.5% to 20% of the student population in districts across the Commonwealth have been identified as eligible for IEPs. And that's relatively consistent. I mean, I don't look at this data every year. These are kind of generalizations based on my knowledge and experience. That's generally pretty consistent. You know,
yeah.
I certainly think that the mandates district to district are similar. I think if you're talking about students staying in or going out of district either on their own, right, or staying seeking public funding for an out of district placement, I think as Ms. Wilson can certainly speak better to than I can, it's really about building our programs within. One of the things, based on my experience, that really frustrates me about the process is that when we do apply public funding to a private out-of-district placement, that does nothing for the next student coming through our system, mm-hmm. right? So it diverts funds solely for the benefit of one student within our district, but we're not building, right, a cohesive program that's going to apply to all students throughout. So it's one of the, every district wrestles with this because you're dealing with the legal claims on one ish end and you're dealing with the financial aspects of that, but you're also trying to invest in your existing populations to serve them coming forward as well. And it can be very difficult to do both at the same time.
I have one third question was, and maybe you could look at it sort of broadly, but I'm sort of trying to understand if you could estimate like the a percent increase in special education budgets over the last 5 years that is due to sort of increase in legal changes in legislation that relate to sort of the legal burden and the legal process.
Sure. I would say that I would not be able to give any estimate on that. However, what I would say that the increase in the kind of what I would describe as the administrative burden on school districts are not exclusive to special education. Mm-hmm. There certainly have been, you could argue, more expansive interpretation to the law under IDEA, but there's really been not any significant in the last several years change to the IDEA. There have been expansive interpretations of Section 504, but if you look at the laws that have been passed over the last several years in the state level particularly, you're talking about the Bullying Prevention Intervention Act. You're talking about the concussion protocol. You're talking about the significant changes under MGLC 71-37H3/4 in the discipline law. Not all of those came with no increase in funding. They are not funded, but you could apply, similarly like we were talking about with the records access officer, a full-time equivalency to the implementation, and I'm sure that Mr. Barker could attest to the time that the new law takes and these new laws take to implement. And a lot of the times that, speaking for myself individually, I understand and appreciate the policy imperatives that the legislature and the governor are thinking about when they pass these laws, but on the ground it can be difficult when you have finite resources to comply with all of them when they're not adding significant resources towards the implementation of those particular laws. So I'd say it's not that aspect I don't see as limited to special education is my answer in short.
Thank you.
Well, we didn't want to shoot the messenger. As Mrs.
that.
Webb said. Do you have one more?
I do. So it seems to me that there's sort of a conflict being set up because parents, understandably, were our children's advocates.
Yeah.
And so the law requires us to provide the, as you said, the least restrictive environment, one that's going to keep mm-hmm. the children in with other children as much as possible. But there's always that perception of the grass is greener, mm-hmm. potentially that perception of the grass being greener. Are there checks and balances written into this? It sounds like the onus of the defense, if the school makes a decision on a program that's the least restrictive for a student,
sure.
the parent might not feel that way, or an outside advisor might not feel that way, in which case they say challenge this, but then they don't bear any of the expense of that challenge, yeah. If I was hearing you right.
Sure. Well, no, I don't think that would necessarily be an accurate characterization, because most parents, if they're kind of, most parents, not all, if they're building a case to go to the BSEA, they're often expending costs for private experts, private neuropsychological evaluations, costs that are not, unlike their attorney's fees, are not reimbursable if they win. They're also bearing costs of their attorney's fees, and they're also absorbing risk. They might lose. Everybody, my prior experience was as a prosecuting attorney, and one thing I learned was trying jury cases, you just never know what the decider of fact is going to do, right? And so there's always risk in pursuing and following through on litigation from both sides, and for families that can be significant financial burden in doing that. And also, from a legal standpoint, the parents, if they're filing, they do have the burden of proof, but often in practicality that does very quickly shift for us to prove how the student made effective progress.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much for being here tonight. You've given us a lot to think about. I'm going to suggest that if anyone in the committee reflects on this and has a follow-up question, maybe we could send it through Dr. Doherty to you.
Thank you so much. My pleasure to be here. Congratulations to the swim team, and good luck in the Super Bowl.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Mr. Bacher.
Yeah.
I look forward to this every year. And really, my kids are not at the high school yet, so it's always like a sneak peek of coming attractions.
Well, we're happy to share. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the school committee. Ms. Lynn Williams, our Director of Guidance, and myself, excited to present a couple of things. First, more kind of business update on NEASC, and then later some updates around our new schedule, and then also some college admissions data. So we appreciate you making some time for us tonight. You guys all have packets. Would you like us to...
No, we can see over
fine.
You. You can
we
stay
can
there,
Lena.
You
can
stay
fine.
There. Yeah, because then it mic's better for
yeah.
the people at home.
Okay.
So just an update on our NEASC accreditation process. So as you all, I'm sure, recall, we had brought this to a halt several years ago, along with a number of other schools and superintendents, just due to a number of variables. Obviously, Reading had been performing very well at the high school, but just concerns around kind of the one-size-fits-all approach. That certainly there are some positive things that any accrediting body does bring to the school district, but the cost involved, some of the initiatives that really didn't allow for the differentiation of a student body, student school initiatives, was a pretty rigid process. And so under the leadership of Dr. Doherty and other area superintendents, there's a collective effort to really have NEASC look as a body to really see how they could better streamline and make some improvements. And over the past couple of years, they really have done that under the leadership of Director George Edwards, who's a former principal, along with his committee, really have tried to find what's the heart of the accreditation process, some of the new standards that reflect what schools are trying to do. This day and going forward, but also understanding that every school is different, student body is different, demographics are different, and being able to maintain high standards while understanding those differences. And as we looked closely, I mean, NEASC and the accreditation process still remains a very important part of high school's portfolio. And so some of the reasons, obviously, that we're familiar with is accreditation is still important for college applications. And there's a varying degree, and Ms. Williams can speak to that better than I can, but depending upon where the schools are that students are applying to, but certainly the New England colleges, the Eastern, East Coast colleges. But we also felt, especially as a newer principal, that it was a good chance for us to kind of collectively take a look at ourselves and our practices. And sometimes it's hard because we're so successful. And that can be both a positive and a negative. It's hard to notice where we should make some changes. And having an independent body providing us with some neutral standards that all schools are being measured by allowed for that collective kind of glance versus me coming in and saying, here's what we need to do to become better. And so it's an inclusive look at, you know, how can we improve in all areas. The other thing, again, is it's really just a chance to celebrate, I think, publicly and recognize and validate a lot of the good work that already goes on, you know, through the independent eyes of NEASC. Actually, I'm going to jump around a little bit here. So some of the changes and the key improvements that that you'll notice is, again, really being less prescriptive in some of the standards. Take, for instance, some of the common standards that schools struggled with was implementing advisory or trying to strive for heterogeneous groupings in schools. And in the past, it had really been one very prescriptive way that, that schools had to implement these initiatives. And in many cases, schools were doing pretty well with those efforts, but it just didn't fit into this defined process. And so NEASC recognizes that they needed to look at things a little more holistically and see that the spirit of those standards was being accomplished, and really looking at it more thoughtfully versus just a compliance exercise on heterogeneity or advisory or a number of other standards that, that were embedded. Also, they recognized, as you just heard from Michael Joyce, just the massive number of state mandates, federal mandates, and the task of, you know, kind of going into a four-year process in some cases, while still maintaining and looking at the standards that NEASC has set forth, but also maintaining progress in some of those state and federal mandates. And so NEASC has done a better job of working with DESE to make sure that, you know, we're recognizing all the different poles that schools are facing and districts are facing and making sure that they're better aligned. They're also looking and recognizing that our school improvement process that is inherent in all school districts and all schools is really the same tool and lever in trying to make those more in lockstep with one another. And so instead of having it be sort of two parallel processes, really looking at what do the schools feel the areas of weakness and the areas for growth are, and how does that fit into the standards, and try and just help schools arrive at a school improvement plan that, that complements the standards that NEASC has set, rather than doing it as an either or. Also, they're more flexible in some of the initiatives I mentioned. They've also made strides around technology. So the days of having, for those of us who have participated in NEASC and accreditation, you know, hundreds of binders and thousands of pages and, you know, those milk crates that were ready for NEASC to come in and review, they've kind of caught up with the time and have a fairly advanced and effective portal system. So just helping to streamline use of technology as we make changes in the writing. And lastly, it's just a shorter visit and consists of a smaller team, partially because they'll do a better job of front-loading the visit and having schools do their own kind of pre-self-study and really advertise or show what they're already doing that's consistent with the standards. And so by doing that, when the visit happens in that fourth year, they've already got a pretty good glance at what schools are doing in the areas they need to improve upon. So as far as a timeline, go back a page now. So the timeline that we're currently operating under, and this is somewhat tentative, we're beginning the pre-self study or the self-assessment and then the development of an improvement plan fall of 2016, so currently, and then headed into the spring of 2017. We'll work with members from NEASC to begin taking a look at how that self-study has, the pre-self-study, excuse me, has shaped up. And once NEASC is kind of approved and says, yep, we agree that those standards that you guys have shown you feel good about, then we can really focus our efforts on some of the standards that we think we need some improvement upon. And that really begins the work of 2017 and 18, so year three, where we implement the improvement plan that's been approved by NEASC and begin to collect evidence to support that. So year four is 2018, 2019, that's really the visit. And again, it's a smaller, less expensive visit, but that's really where they'll do some of the common exercises of shadowing students, talking with teachers and parents, and just really trying to get a sense of the school and aligned with the standards. And then year five is where we submit the plan based on those standards and in based upon their recommendations from the visit. And then that cycle, of course, depending how we're doing, we'll either submit an update based on those recommendations on how we're doing in terms of those areas of improvement, and prepare for the visit in the 10-year cycle again in 2024. So it's hard to say those numbers, 2024. So just a little bit more in depth in year one. So for those of us who may not be familiar, I'll just give you a little bit more insight. The NEASC will provide us with a survey that we give to students, parents, and faculty, and we'll really use the survey results to help guide and substantiate some of the things that as a steering committee we think are places to improve upon. We will provide NEASC with a list of those areas, and again, they will either agree with us and ask us to focus instead on other standards, or they'll ask for further evidence, support, and ask us to expand our look. So they're really, I think, trying to allow schools for themselves to identify where we should focus our efforts with that self-improvement plan, the school improvement plan, excuse me. Now, the process is a little less cumbersome instead of having all the faculty constantly involved every step of the way, which often amounted, in theory, it seemed like a nice exercise, you know, consensus building, everyone's involved, but often for those of us who have participated, turned into a wordsmithing exercise. And in some cases, some of the staff who really aren't involved with certain parts of the standard on a day-to-day basis. What does remain, though, in terms of school involvement is there's a vetting process. Every standard continues to have a vote by the entire staff. And so it doesn't, we continue to stay away from this three people running the, you know, the self-assessment, three people running the accreditation process, and losing kind of the true opinion of the students, all the stakeholders involved. And then, as I mentioned earlier, year two and three really begins that plan review with the collaborative conference, which will only be one school day. So folks from NEASC, a small committee, will help go through that. And then using the online portal system, as I mentioned before. And then really deciding where will we focus our school improvement plan, how that ties together. And then lastly, the visit itself. And you know, one of the small details that really will end up saving money is that infamous Sunday where the big kickoff and celebration, which is nice, but costs quite a bit of money in the visit. And I think NEASC recognizes in times of thin budgets, it just isn't appropriate, and has made the adjustments accordingly. So in that year four, they'll give us those primary areas of recommendation, and that will start the 2-year cycle of feedback based on those suggestions. After the visit, within 6 weeks, we're expected to produce a report. And they will either make the decision to continue our accreditation, which we currently do have, or depending on the results, may elect to put us on warning or on probation. We do have a year to kind of make those changes if possible before we arrive at that status, if we were faced with that. And then again, it's that 2-year, if we are on either warning or on probation, a 2-year and a 4-year cycle in terms of how we're making progress on some of those recommendations. And then lastly, just some updates on, again, where we are. We're actually partnering with Burlington. The superintendent, the principal there, and their team has already been underway in the process. They are using some of the updated standards and on a different timeline than us, but it's a nice cohort for us to kind of run by what's working, what's not, both of the new standards, but also with the new technology. And you know, I'm very impressed with, I think, NEASC's leadership, that they're very interested in our feedback. I think sometimes, you know, piloting things is a dirty word. In this case, I think they very much want us as a partner and are anxious to take our feedback as a school that does well, but is anxious to continue growing. So it's been a nice partnership. And hopefully we'll begin that survey in the spring, as I mentioned before. So that's it on NEASC and the accreditation process. I don't know if there's questions around that.
I think that sounds very encouraging. So I'm thrilled. Thank you for the work you're doing.
Quick question.
Oh, Mr. Nye.
So the standards you talk about, are these NEASC standards or national standards?
Yeah, so they are NEASC standards.
Okay.
And, you know, I've really, I think, been a collaborative effort from looking at also federal standards and national standards around school improvement. But they are NEASC standards.
What do you, what's the perception of those standards?
I think that, you know, most of the surrounding school areas really do see that that NEASC has balanced nicely the theoretical with the practical, and understands the importance, again, of different demographics in different communities, but I think also has an eye towards rigor and excellence and provides standards that allow all communities to kind of strive for that in spite of their different challenges. So I think for the most part, when we talk to other principals and superintendents, they feel as though NEASC has finally kind of gotten it.
Good. So trying to remember, was it 2 years ago now that we pulled out of this, or?
Three.
Three, okay.
Well, wait a minute, we didn't pull out.
Well, went on sabbatical.
Sent a message.
Curious, what's the rush to get back in? Have we seen a problem with our current situation, or that we need to do this? Or I know they cut their cost. I mean, that makes sense if they're using more technology and throwing less parties. But you know, I mean, I guess was there criticisms that caused this, or?
So I mean, we have fielded some questions from parents, and I think Ms. Williams can speak to it better in terms of the college piece. But just raising concerns around, you know, do we carry the same accredited status that other schools do? And although NEASC is obviously a New England based system, other high schools around the country have their own accrediting body.
I will say when I did the research up front and talked to many different colleges all over the country, there were questions because they wanted to know what that meant. And as a guidance director and a parent in the town, I feel more comfortable in the college admissions process knowing that we have this behind us. I don't think that it will negatively, you know, no one was going to say that it was negatively going to definitely impact, but there were definitely questions that were raised specifically around the Massachusetts state colleges and universities. So I think there's a comfort having that accreditation behind us. So that's my take.
I think
the college
other
piece.
Important, it's always good to use a process to take a look at yourself and see how you're doing against a set of standards. And NEASC is certainly a way that you can do that. And it's healthy for a school to be going through that process. As Adam said, also particularly with a newer principal, it gives him an opportunity also with a newer, we do have a newer staff as well. These are all important things as you're taking a look at what you're doing and how you can improve.
Well, I think you're correct now that they've gotten their act together.
Right.
But we made a conscious decision 3 years ago because they weren't doing the
correct.
Job.
Correct. Correct.
So I just have a question about, so we have our school improvement plan, though, which is separate from this, normal school.
No, it's aligned.
Level.
That's
oh,
part
aligned.
Of the reason
okay.
why... Yes.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that they were.
Actually, to add a little bit to this, the process that we use,
yes.
which is a DESE process called Planning for Success,
yeah.
they are now working with NEASC to use that process. So we're already ahead of the game with that because we're using that process already.
Okay, so it's completely aligned and leveraging the process
yep.
that we have.
Yeah, it just feels as though, again, the leadership at NEASC, and as I mentioned before, George Edwards being a longtime high school principal, I think they just recognize that we, you know, many, many, many schools are more than happy to be reflective and conscious of how to improve, and do look to independent standards as a means to measure how are we comparing, but can't do it on top of everything else. And so I think giving more trust and faith to schools to identify for themselves what do we need to do to improve, as I think has finally kind of resonated, so.
All right.
All right.
Thanks.
Shouldn't say more exciting, but more happy topics, I guess, with our students here. So we're excited about some of the schedule changes that we've made and kind of begun to dip our toe in, you know, the waters of scheduling and trying to just find ways to, you know, utilize the day in a way that's allowing to our students to be successful, to be enriched, to be supported, to kind of grapple with being well-rounded adolescents, but also wanting them to emphasize wellness and de-emphasize stress. And so what we did is, we're excited actually, our intro to marketing class, led by teacher Heather Connors, helped to put together a survey to take a close look at two parts of our newer schedule. And anecdotally, in talking to kids and teachers and parents, had heard very positive things, but really hadn't done a thorough collection of data until the other day. So her intro in a marketing class brainstormed for about a week or two, different questions that would help to get at some of the positives, some of the negatives of the schedule. And we administered that test during one of the blocks. So just to kind of reacquaint folks, the two changes are on Tuesdays, we start our school day at 8 o'clock, but the building is open really at 7:15, but contractually at 7:30 for teachers and students to work together, or for kids to just continue to work on their homework, as the graphs and the data will show you in a moment. But just to help kind of ease into the day and provide kids and teachers a little bit of time together to get some of that work done. Also on Thursday, so that's every Tuesday, on every other Thursday, we had introduced something called a flex block. And the primary driver there was to provide time for our guidance counselors to deliver a curriculum to all the different grade levels and be more proactive, you know, at each level in terms of some of the work that needed to be done for freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors. And so really for the seniors early in the year, there were a number of meetings with their guidance counselors during essentially a school-wide directed study. So for one quarter of the school, they're working closely with their guidance counselors in a smaller group and being able to have personalized attention. And then the other three quarters of the school is in their kind of old homeroom structure, but is allowed to partake in enrichment opportunities that teachers are running, getting extra help, making up tests and exams, as we'll see in a moment. But just giving the school as a whole a chance to do different things that the master schedule can often make very difficult in a high school setting. And that an elementary school and a middle school, with those team models, you often have more of a chance to bring kids together, groups together. And so we wanted to really get beyond the anecdotal and take a close look at how it was going. And so you'll see in a moment here the different questions that were asked. We got pretty good response. It was an electronic survey, but then also it was a paper survey, so we are still tallying the results. But did get electronically about 705 responses. One of the questions the kids thought would be important to ask centered around homework, and that's obviously an important topic, and a separate topic in some ways around maintaining rigor, but also making sure we're not just piling on work, you know, as an exercise of compliance. And so quick glance at the pie chart here. 42% of our students reported having about 1 to 2 hours of homework a night, and then about 26% reported having 2 or 3 hours. And I think they asked that question really with the eye towards, is the schedule helping? Is it helping to get some support, but also to reduce the load of homework? And on the next slide, you'll see pretty convincingly that the students did feel as though both office hours and flex block, at the tune of 89%, really has helped in that area. And so we're very encouraged by that. So maintaining rigor, but also helping kids to be successful in tackling that load, in addition to being well-rounded. Then separately, looking a little bit more closely at flex block, we wanted to see, you know, is that something that folks are, that students are finding beneficial? We are going to be asking staff as well, a similar survey. But 94% of students reported if they were to have it every day, once a week, every other week, or never, would like to have it every day or once a week. And so at the beginning of quarter two, based upon some of that anecdotal evidence and then some of the data here, we decided to do that every day, every week. And so now once a week, we have the flex block, except for on early release days. So it's sort of this complicated system we're trying to hash out. But the kids get it, the staff does, seems to get it. Just felt that in the weeks that we did have an early release, it becomes a little disjointed. You've got office hours on Tuesday, then you've got half day on Wednesday, and then flex block. So about 3 weeks out of every month, we've got flex block built into the schedule. And specifically, just kind of a rating scale, flex block was considered to be at the rate of 89% very helpful, or extremely helpful. And then looking at office hours, similar statistics, 86%, same thing. So it's been met very positively by our student body. The concern we did have, though, was the impact on shortening classes. And so with office hours, on the day that we have office hours, our blocks are reduced about 3 minutes to 53 minutes. And there are a couple blocks where it does vary, like our lunch block has to remain the same time, amount of time. And then on flex block, it's a little shorter at about 47 minutes. But as you can see, when we ask kids if that's had a real detrimental effect on class time, about 89% said reported that there was little to no effect. And in talking anecdotally to teachers, the same thing. Then looking at the activities that students are doing during those office hours, and students were given the choice to answer these questions more than once, or give responses to each of these more than one answer. 74% did report enjoying sleeping a little bit longer, and so I think that's obviously something to look at a little bit more closely. I think we're trying to strive at the high school to give kids more independence. And if we see that, you know, the results are positive, that kids' well-being is met, is positive, that the results in academically are good, then that's certainly not a bad thing. And separately, but related from this, I know that there's a district-wide committee on a late start, you know, which is a topic of discussion, and seems to have really some good merit around having a later start and giving kids a little bit of time to sleep longer. But 39% also kind of talk about really getting extra help during this time, and it's a short window. Again, it's about 30 minutes. 24% reported making up tests and quizzes. And then lastly, about 35% of the kids, depending on the day, use that to complete homework. And we did ask the kids in ways that we could improve the flex block. Specifically, they did talk about wanting to have it more often, so that's why we made that change. The issue we are having a little bit around is the access to the library. We want to make sure that the time is useful. We're not just allowing kids to wander around the building, so the administrators are really present throughout that entire block as much as we can. But we have to, in many cases, the guidance department needs access to computers to do some of their work, whether it's on Naviance and looking at college planning or some of the other programs. So the library is obviously a big place for some of our computers, and just trying to strategically balance the needs of intervention and support, and the library being a good spot for that, but also technology, accessing technology. So we're starting to look closely at how to best distribute the technology in the building during that time. The other thing that we're now looking after quarter one has ended is really trying to leverage that flex block as a tier two intervention, tier three intervention. So as grades are coming in, we're working jointly with our assistant principals and our guidance counselors to really prioritize kids who are struggling, have D's and F's, and really tie them and have them work closely with either their teacher. And in those cases, the teacher may have a homeroom. So we use our department heads to free them up and provide really targeted, specific support, which has just kind of begun. But also looking at ways to create some spaces, depending on where the needs are greatest. And we, again, we're just kind of beginning to see, look at what the trends are. Is there a heavier need in English? Is there a heavier need in math? In which case, you know, we wouldn't want to just have the one-size-fits-all approach that there's someone from every department. We may actually want to free up 5 or 6 math teachers, say, for instance, to provide that intervention. But other suggestions kids made was opening the fitness center, which has already happened. Ms. Graham, our department head, has now provided that, and also access to the gym, whether it's to make up classes or for kids who just need to kind of blow off steam. And we're trying to do a better job of publicizing that to the kids. As a staff, we're using a Google Doc, so teachers are signing up so that they can offer enrichment opportunities. We had a workshop on, what is it, the TI-84 calculator on how to best use that. We've had workshops on different topics, and I think that's one of the intended consequences or benefits from having FlexBlock, is that teachers really start to have different ideas in how to use that. So I don't know if you kids want to talk about a little bit about the schedule and if there's been some positives or negatives that you'd like to share.
Sports and everything, you know that you have a time in the day to get some of that stuff done. So it's built in, it's already there, which is really nice.
And I know for some, like, some students might not have like a study a certain like in like one semester. So FlexBlock can really take away some of the stress like from part of the week. Like if you have if you weren't able, if you were really busy one night, like Wednesday night, and you couldn't get all your homework done, you could end up finishing it in FlexBlock, or if you have a question, you can.
Oh, yes. So can we, I think you said you're still, they're still counting the
we're
the
still
turns.
Telling the results.
Right, so like the response rate, I just would, I'd like to, you know, when you finalize the data, I'd like to see the rest of it. And then I was wondering on the office hours activities, that must have been just sort of open ended question, and people could, they took as many responses as kids wrote down.
Right.
Okay. What it sounds to me, and what you guys are describing also, the students are describing about the FlexBlock in particular, it sort of sounds like a page out of the middle school model. Like, so that, I think that's interesting.
Yeah.
To me.
No, and as I said for the onset, I mean, the schedule is always a bear at the high school, in all high schools, because you're really trying to allow different levels and the rigor and all the different competing graduation requirements. But it's just so important, again, to provide time. The system principals and myself were talking about ways in which they can utilize that time better to connect with their classes. And, so that is exactly one of the other positives you mentioned.
I don't know if anyone from the high school will be able to come to Breaking Points. Well, probably Dr. Doherty would be there. But it would be, I think, you know, that one of the aspects of that film and being able to speak to this change as, you know, part of making progress, you know, from however many years ago that we saw Race to Nowhere for. Okay. So I think that might be good. That's the 30th. Hopefully we get a good turnout for that event. But I think this sort of speaks to some pieces of that. And I'm so much happier than I was 45 minutes ago.
You're right.
You could help.
Thank you.
I think I speak for all of us when we say that sounds like a really great way to tackle the issues of anxiety that we know are problematic in Reading and nationwide. So I'm thrilled with that. And it's really nice to have you here to actually validate that and explain it, because it adds face to what's data. So thank you for sharing your experiences. As far as the office hours and the 74% that jumps off the page a little bit, have you had any conversations? Obviously, issues of sleep, I happen to be very passionate about it. So I know that's a countrywide problem, that teenagers do not get enough sleep. So I know it's a problem. This probably is not a good solution. 30 minutes once a week is not a solution to that problem. The late start time committee is, there's other systemic solutions to that problem. So have you had any conversations, or are you doing any thinking about how you could do office hours differently? And what came to my mind is, could that be at the end of the day instead of at the beginning of the day? I'm just wondering if you had any reaction to that number.
Yeah, I think it's certainly one that jumps out at you, as you said, and you know, I think it dovetails nicely with our district-wide conversation on Late Start Committee, which certainly isn't unique to just Reading. I think it was Newton North who recently went in that direction or is going to go in that direction. We have not kind of dug any deeper at this point. Last year, as we were looking at and continue now to look at a schedule overall, as this is just kind of a tweak, we did look at a model that was, that had these office hours every day for the first 30 minutes, and three of the 5 days a week, I think the schedule is New Albany High School in Ohio, so three of the days did have the 30 minutes dedicated to the office hours as we see here for our school. Two of the 5 days were really given to teacher collaboration, to meetings with parents, and it really provided a balance of kind of killing two birds with one stone. The students had sleep time or were able to use that as they saw fit, but also provided teachers, you know, in the middle school model, we have that common planning time that's very difficult at the high school level to find. So a place where we will continue to explore for sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, just one of the issues that I experienced with my sons and is that the afternoon, even though there's a certain amount of time before the sports practice, they tend to, it's very short for them.
Yeah.
And so I know I would encourage the students, my sons, to make an appointment and see the teacher. So it was always, I think I experienced more success with that, with them sort of making that effort, because the teachers would always come in early, not just, you know, for this special arrangement.
Right.
So I think it just, in practice, it ended up being hard for them to focus in that short amount of time. I see Alex is like shaking her head. It's just like, because you're getting on to your next thing and you don't want to miss the bus to your event or whatever.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you've just ended school. You need a little break.
Yeah.
It's kind of along those lines. What was your reaction to the homework reported data?
I think it's a conversation, as I mentioned, that we really need to look at more closely. We've just begun work with kind of a state partnership and a company called CAST. You may be familiar with this, looking at universal design for learning.
Mm-hmm.
And looking, I think, at the same time, both at just instruction, assessment, and trying to make sure that our homework is done intentionally. It isn't just, you know, for the sake of doing it. So it is definitely, it's important data. It's data that we really are just seeing. But I think it does give us a place to begin and look at, is the homework, you know, really accomplishing what we hoped it would? Or are there places that we can emphasize kind of that phrase you hear from time to time, quality versus quantity?
Yeah, and it was a legitimate question, because
yeah.
I didn't have a reaction to it other than that's interesting.
Right.
I don't know how to feel about that.
Yeah.
So I could see how it's the beginning of a conversation, because that's how it feels to me.
Yeah.
I guess I looked at that too, and my first reaction or my first question to that was, where is it coming from?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, is that big chunk coming from the strong college prep?
Yep.
Or the college? So I think that's an important piece of data to know where the homework, the bigger hours, are they coming from the AP courses?
No, again, we're looking again as a school at differentiating instruction and assessment, and I think being careful about you know, just increasing the volume of work in the name of rigor, as opposed to increasing the level of questioning and the level of thinking, which may still take the same amount of time, but requires, you know, just a different level of readiness that's consistent with the levels, and that may be the better approach.
Yes, I think that's interesting, because we probably all looked at that and might have had some little perspectives about like what we thought. So I guess I don't necessarily want to say that, but I do think I think that it's really important to dive into that.
Yeah.
And I've never been a proponent of no homework, and I know that for every university, every school that you go to, they'll tell you anywhere between 4 and 6 hours a night. You guys are going to be in class, and you're going to expect to spend 4 to 6 hours on your homework if you're going to do well. So I think
that we have to prepare students to have that stamina, but we need to, it's our job to make sure that it's rigorous and relevant and productive, and that it's balanced.
And balanced their overall health, yeah.
Right, but and also balanced in terms of, does it make sense in terms of the courses, the levels, things like that. So I'm happy to see the data.
And I should add too, one of the other things that's we're able to provide during flex block in terms of tier two intervention is, and we're just beginning this, but is some group efforts from our counselors, our social workers, providing kids who are struggling with different social emotional issues, but really providing group support on a regular basis during that time. And then also looking at more closely at why kids are getting D's or F's or are struggling in school, and coming up with tier two interventions around organization, around executive functioning. And we just actually asked our school psychologists to deliver some of that support in groups, which is, I think, a positive step in helping kids too.
All right. Thank you so much.
Sure.
What's next?
Ms. Williams.
All right, so I have the pleasure of talking about college admissions. And there's a reason why Mr. Bonker has his job and the lawyer has his job. This is definitely my passion and things that I like to talk about. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk specifically about last year's graduating class and how they did with the college admissions and SAT scores and things like that. And I think one of the things that's important to remember is that every graduating class is very different. So some of the statistics changes a little bit. If there are drastic numbers, that's when I'm alarmed, but little percentages here and there, I'm not so alarmed, because every class is just made up with different kids and different strengths and struggles and all of that stuff. So with the class of 2016, 83% went off to four-year colleges, which is a little bit of a dip from the class before that, where we were at around 87%. 11% went to two-year colleges, which is up from previous years where it was around 6%. 1% went to prep technical schools, and then less than 1% went off to the armed forces. I'm part of the Middlesex Guidance Directors League, and so once a month we have a meeting. We get to gather and we talk about a whole variety of different things. And a side conversation that I was having with a few of the directors was around how many of the schools, including Reading, has seen a little bit of a dip of the percentage of students who are going off to four-year schools. And so what was nice is to hear that Reading's not alone. And so we're just at the point, just having the conversations of, like, why is that? And our quick conversation has, you know, leads us to believe that the increase in students' anxiety and struggles and hospitalizations when they get to senior year, it's very overwhelming. So I think that plays a little part in it. I think just a little part for some students. While we have many students who are struggling, still going off and doing wonderful things. So I'm not saying that they're not, but I think that there are more students who are deciding to take a year off, figure out who they are, getting the supports that they need before they're paying a high price to go off to college, which I do think for some students is a good thing to do.
So, yeah. Linda, what was the two-year college last year? Do we know that? You may have said it. I just
so in 2016, it's 11%. 2015, right. It was 6%.
Okay, so I would disagree with the reason. I think that our bigger reason is the cost of a four-year college.
Absolutely, and so
and a lot of students I've heard are going for 2 years get an associate and then transfer
to a four-year.
Right. Please know that I was not saying that this is the reason, the only
right.
reason. I think that is a piece of the
came
puzzle
out
that
the
I
wrong
think.
Way,
yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's a piece of the puzzle that we just need to be paying attention to. But you're right, cost is a huge piece. Wanting to stay closer to home, there's a whole variety of reasons why students choose the path that they take.
We have one more question.
So you did mention the gap year. I didn't quite. How many students do you think, or what's the percentage of students that take a gap year?
You know, in last year's class, there was very few students that did a gap year. And, you know, so everybody's definition of a gap year is a little bit different. So I just want to clarify what my definition of a gap year is, because it's not just taking a year off.
There are so many wonderful gap year programs that are out there for students to go out, participate with other students in an organized program where they get to learn about themselves, become leaders, figure out what their interests are. And there's just so many wonderful programs out there. Oftentimes what happens is that students do a gap year program at, well, they apply for gap year programs at the same time that they're applying for college admissions. They get accepted to both. They take the year, do the gap year. They defer their college admissions for 1 year, so they really have a two-year plan if they choose to do that two-year plan. We only had a few students who did that last year. We had more students who chose to go off and work in what they're calling a gap year, which technically it is, but taking time off and working and figuring out themselves.
So that's about 5% looking at the...
I don't have the percentages off the top of my head right
5%
now.
5% that
so.
Don't go on. Some of it,
yes,
maybe gap, some of, you know, well, gap in the way you define it, are just into the work world.
Yeah. I think somebody else had a question.
I thought so, too.
Well, my question was about the 4.7% that's not accounted for there, and I think you just answered that question. And the assumption that I also am having is that this is of those who graduate. So in terms of the numbers who are graduating, those numbers are the same. Have those changed from the past?
The numbers changing of students who are not graduating?
No, our graduation rate has been really consistent the past 4 years, I can speak to it, which is exceptionally high, you know, when you compare to many, many districts. I think we had a couple of students last year, and they did eventually, actually by the end of the summer, complete their graduation requirements, which is always great to see.
Let's see if you can make it to the second slide.
Yeah. All right, so where our students go. So you will see that in last year's class, they went to 116 different colleges. 76% stay in New England, and 50% stay in Massachusetts. This is pretty consistent from the last few years. There wasn't really that much of a change over the past few years when I looked at the data. 9% went off to New York. 14% went outside of New England and New York. That's a little bit down from previous years where it was in that 19-20%. The part that stood out but is not surprising to me is 56% are attending their first choice college. Now this data, I mean, this is reported from students, so what their idea of their first choice changes from when they're applying versus when they're accepted. And so, you know, I kind of look at this percentage a little bit looser than some of the other ones, but it is down compared to previous years. And I think some of you know from experience or you've heard, while we had a lot of wonderful news in last year's graduating class, we did have some disappointing, actually quite a bit of disappointments for students. That's concerning to me as a guidance director. What's going on? Is this a Reading thing or is this a bigger issue? The guidance directors, there's 12 schools that attend our meeting. What we did is we shared our data as far without student names, and shared our data as far as, you know, 1 through 20, SAT scores, where they got in, where they did not get in, and we're pretty consistent with many of the schools. There were many disappointments across the board in all the districts. So some of that has to do with more and more students are applying to more schools. It's more competitive. So that's a big piece of it. I will also say that when there's a higher number of students who are applying, schools get to be more selective, which just makes it challenging for our students. And what I'm trying to help parents and students understand is that you're not just competing against other Reading students, you're competing against Winchester and somebody in California and Chicago and all over the place. And so I think all of that data is really important. And so one of the things that Naviance has done this year, they've updated their program and it's made it so much easier for students to access information. There's a lot of information in Naviance, but now what they're doing is they're helping students understand what each specific college is specifically looking for. And the college puts in the information of what is most important. So for some schools, it's the GPA and the SAT scores. Other schools, it's, you know, their extracurricular activities or, you know, a whole variety of different things. So it's nice that Naviance has updated that and helped us out a little bit with that information. I did talk to many colleges because there are some students who, where they applied, you know, they have their reaches, they have their middle ground schools, they have their most likely, and some of the students didn't get into schools that they considered were their most likely. And so what is the reason by that? And it was interesting for me to talk to a few of those schools where they, because they had so many applicants, they got to be more selective. And if they felt that it was a student safety, then they weren't necessarily accepting those students because they were accepting other students who they thought were more likely to go. So the college admissions, it's one of the things that I love and hate about this job. It's changing so much that it's always hard to predict from year to year. So I'm hoping this year is going to be a successful year for our students.
Can I ask a question on that last slide? The 116 different, is that normal? Or is that higher or lower than?
In the previous years, it was 124. So, you know, in that range.
I have a question on the slide too. I feel like last year when you presented, you made the comment that you would like to see Reading students look outside of New England. And if I'm remembering that correctly, I'm wondering if you're still having that sense and if you think that would be beneficial.
I do think that will be beneficial because when you apply, when our students are applying to schools farther away, they're not competing with all of the Boston students. So I think that's helpful. Mm-hmm. I think it's also, you know, our students like to stay close to home. And I get that, you know, there are many students who either their families want them to stay close to home, there's a financial benefit being in Massachusetts, there's so many different reasons, the cost of flying to schools and things like that. But I feel like this year, and I don't know yet because we don't have all the data, but I'm hearing more students are applying out, but I can't say that that's because of the guidance counselors, although I would like to take credit for it. I think it's maybe word's getting out a little bit. All right, so the next slide is the five-year comparison data. At just the number of applications, this is always interesting to me, and this year in particular, because I was significantly more stressed the week before November 1st than I have been in a very long time. And, you know, you always kind of wonder why. So what you can see in the first part is that each year the number of applications that students are submitting are going up. And so last year for the 2016, I want to say that we were at 2,400 transcripts we sent out in that range, 2,400. For the November 15th deadline, we already had sent out 1,800 transcripts. So we are already above
this
where
year.
We were this year. Yep. So I have 33 students on my caseload. I had 26 that had that applied for November 1st deadlines. So the nice part about that is that my recommendations and things like that are done. The downside to it is more students are applying early. It'll be interesting to see the competitiveness with that.
Yeah.
So I think we're at 67% have applied early action to at least one school. So, and that's also just November 1st, November 1st, 15th, not necessarily the December 1st, December 15th. The number of colleges, as I stated before, relatively consistent. Acceptances were up a little bit, but that's also because there was more students applying to more colleges last year, so I would anticipate that. Early decision went down a little bit last year. I don't necessarily know at this point, you know, in for class of 2017 where we stand. And then early action last year, 2016 went up by 200 students applying, not 200 students, 200 applications for early action, and I definitely know this year's graduating class, it's even higher.
Is that the applications or acceptances? The
applications.
Yeah.
And UMass has a November 1st, so with such a high percentage of students who are applying to UMass. They're the Common App. Once you already have the Common App done, why not send it to other schools? Unless there are the schools that you're being strategic and you want to wait for first quarter grades, or you're waiting for your SAT scores if you took them later, things like that. So I hate to say it, there's a little bit of a game in it, and it's really unfortunate, but each school is so different. So I often tell students and parents what the advice that I would give one student might be different advice that I give to somebody else. And so that's why it's so important for them to be connecting with us. And in a little bit, I'm going to tell you how we've changed things to really connect more with our seniors. So as you know, the admissions criteria, there's many different parts that the colleges are looking at, from the academics, transcripts, the deciles, GPA, extracurricular activities, the standardized test. And I talked a little bit about this last year, and I think I alluded to this just a few minutes ago with Naviance. So we give a general presentation to our seniors as well as the parents and give them information. These are the things that colleges are looking for. But every college is different of what they're placing as the priority. And Naviance has changed their platform, I guess you'd say, that each college can identify what they are specifically looking for, and they rate all of these things. So kids know how important community service is to this particular college, how important are the SAT scores, in whatever it is that the college is looking for. So I think that that's really going to open the eyes of many students and parents where they were just kind of questioning things. So the next slide is the SAT, the mean scores. So we're relatively the same for years. We took a little bit of a dip in the critical reading for the class of 2016, as well as the math. The biggest portion was in the writing. I will say, and I don't know this for a fact, there were more and more students who didn't care so much about the writing because they heard that colleges didn't care about that so much. So they were putting a lot more energy into the critical reading and the math section. I'd say more and more students are taking the exam multiple times, and they're focusing critical reading one time, and then the next time they're taking it, they're focusing on math, which, you know, when you have the ability to pick your highest scores and score choice and all of that stuff, I think that's working out for them.
I don't think they did that when we took them. You got the one number.
They did not do that.
Ask a question.
But as you can see, we are well above the state average.
Quick question. So what do you see for colleges looking at, you know, this talk that they pay less attention to SATs? Is that, do you think that's accurate? Or
I do think that's accurate because more schools are score choice. So score optional, sorry. And so I do think that that's the case. But there are some schools that this is when they get thousands and thousands of applications, they're looking at the GPA and SAT scores because they have to have their numbers go down before they can look at everything. So, but when we had the college fair, there were somewhere around 125 colleges, and we have a dinner beforehand. So the guidance counselors all separate. We have our questions. We're mingling with them, and that's one of the questions that we are talking to them about, their SAT scores and how important. And, you know, colleges are careful on what they're going to say because they want to be able to have the flexibility to admit who they want to admit. But in general, the message is coming out that there's more and more schools who are caring less about the SATs. With that, though, when you look at some of the data of where our kids have gotten accepted compared to the Middlesex, the schools in the Middlesex League, SAT scores kind of stand out for some of the really top students. And so for those Ivy League schools, the top tier schools, they're looking at the SAT scores.
They seem to be the ones that are sort of saying they're not looking at it.
I don't think that was true.
Yeah.
Schools like Bowdoin, I think it was one that said they were not going to look at SATs anymore. A couple of those small Ivies,
yep.
I'm shouldn't say it's exactly Bowdoin, but I think it was one of those schools up in Maine.
Oh, was that, I'm sorry.
Yeah. I think you sort of alluded to earlier the yield, you know, the colleges managing their yield and sort of that conundrum of being sort of overqualified but yet not sort of getting there.
Mm-hmm.
I think the other thing is the colleges, they're, if they're managing, they're trying to manage demographics and diversity, and they're trying to accomplish certain goals in their overall student body. But I think, you know, at the same time, they do not, they want to bring students in that will be successful in their environment. And so I think to that extent, they can't completely ignore the SAT and those standardized tests, because they need the student to be a good match and have a good opportunity for success. And I think, you know, they definitely look at that and have to balance that. So I sit on an advisory board of an honors college, and this is one of the big struggle areas, is we want to do that, but we can't completely ignore that.
Right, right. The next slide is about the ACTs, and this was not in the slides last year because our numbers, I would say that there were not as many students who had kind of taken them in the past for us to pay attention, but it definitely stood out in last year's class, this year's class, with the number of students who are taking the ACTs. And that's largely due to the changes in the SATs. So the SATs have changed quite a bit, and they're following more of the ACT model. And so more students wanted to take the ACTs, one, to kind of see where their scores compared, but also the ACTs are, in their eyes, kind of the safe bet, because colleges know how to predict and know what the ACTs are all about. So they were playing it safe. When you look at the conversion charts, our students do relatively the same SATs versus ACTs. You don't notice a huge difference, but every once in a while, like, we do have students who have done significantly better on one test versus another. I have a student who's on my caseload right now, and she definitely significantly did better on the ACTs, and I, without a doubt, that will help her in the admissions process. And she chose not to submit her SAT. So it's one of those things that, you know, I'm careful because I don't want to over-test students. I don't want them to become overly stressed on all of these standardized tests that they have to do. But at the same time, each student is an individual, and we have to figure out what's the best thing for them. And I just think more students are choosing to take both just to see. And then what they usually do is they kind of choose between those two. After they've taken both of them, they see which one fits them, and then they take it a second time to see if they can improve their scores even more. AP, that's the next slide. Thank you. Each year, the number goes up. So last year, we administered 408 exams to a total of 205 students. I don't know the numbers off the top of my head for this year's class. I should have looked at that today. But we have two more AP classes this year compared to in past years. So I think that the numbers will be increased for the class of 2017. 179 AP exams got the scores were 3 or higher, which is nice. You know, I think that's something that internally we have to have a conversation about, of where do we really want to see our students. So do we want majority of the students taking the exams to, like, what percentage do we want to have that 3 or higher? You know, there's different ways of looking at that. Sometimes some districts are okay with a lower percentage of students getting a 3 or higher because you're exposing more students to AP courses and the rigor, getting them prepared for college. On the flip side, there are districts who want to see the higher percentage getting the 3 or higher because that helps them as far as getting credit in colleges. So I think we just have to have a conversation internally with our leadership team of what we want to do and where we want to go. I want to be very careful that while I see huge benefits to the AP courses, I also want to make sure that we are not overdoing it for our students and going down this, you know, path where it's gonna lead to more anxiety and stress and all of that stuff. So, you know, we have to walk this fine, you know, balance. What's right for one student isn't necessarily right for another. There are many students who can handle multiple, but then there's that competition piece with other students who think that they can handle it because their friend's doing it. So those are just conversations that we're having internally of where we wanna go. Mr. Bacher and I have talked about making sure that we have a wide range of AP options for students. We are heavily math and science focused as far as AP, and we're spreading that out a little bit. The plan was for next year to see if we can have more AP courses. With the budget the way it is, I think we just have to have a conversation, is next year the right year, or is it the following year, or things like that, and we just have to play that out once we have more information.
Yeah, we're looking at next year, we're looking at targeting AP economics and AP psychology, AP psych being one of the entry-level classes that a lot of kids will take who may not be, you know, your top-tier students but really want to take a risk. So the other piece that sometimes runs into our AP participation is our schedule, and so in our graduation requirements. So trying to find ways so that we don't just have kids in their junior and senior year alone, often just their senior year alone, taking all these AP courses. So trying to stretch that out. In schools that Lynn and I have worked at, you know, kids are taking it sophomore year, freshman year even. It's like, you know, Ms. Williams said, trying not to overdo it with kids, but also afford them multiple entry points to take in that if they want to, if they're prepared.
Well, I think you said it really well, that what's right for one student isn't right for another. And if you've got a freshman or sophomore who really has a passion and an appetite and the ability, that's a strong argument for it. As long as you can manage the competition, that's what's right for one isn't right for the other.
Right.
Yeah.
I think I'm like glad to hear that, because I think it's important to understand like what are the goals, because as you look at, you know, class by class, mm-hmm. you know, what was achieved, you have to just say, well, is that what we hope to get out of this class,
right.
or did we not see what we wanted, and we
right.
need to, you know, look at where we're maybe not meeting the need, so that you can have, maybe you want to get, you know, 2% more students in the able to get a 4 or 5, but you're
mm-hmm.
perfectly happy with most
mm-hmm.
of them, you know, earning a 3, and then just having them be really, really well prepared. They don't have to, and that whole dialogue with the universities, and every university is different in terms of what their policy is on what a student should do with their AP credit based on
right.
their test grade. So,
right.
Every
college and every major in the college is different, and what I've heard from many students is, although they've received a 4 or 5 and they could get credit for their college, they're choosing to take the class again because it's a nice, it helps them with the transition to school.
There's just as many though that will say, if, you know, really capable student, don't do that because your easy A will not become that. You will
yep.
be lazy. So I mean, so I think it's really important to say, you know, to look at the classes that you run and you know, are we achieving the goal, and just knowing that you're gonna have a spread of those scores, and maybe that's what you want.
Right.
Yeah, I don't think it has to be an either or. I think we really want it to be two-pronged, where, you know, we wanna have our top-tier kids really striving for 4s and 5s, but also really encouraging kids to challenge up. And having taken a, you know, a college level course is really a great goal to have as well. So
yeah.
Hopefully those aren't, you know, mutually exclusive.
So as I'm looking here at the next slide, I got a little bit nervous when I was just sitting here, because you'll see a typo. There were not 113 AP scholars with honors in 2015. There were 13. So the number did not go from 113 to 17, thankfully.
Pretty good.
But as you can see, the numbers are relatively the same, except for the AP scholars with distinction definitely went up. Again, there were more students who were taking it. AP scholars with distinction is scored a 3.5 on all exams and scored 3 or higher on 5 or more. And we did have one national AP scholar which scored 4 or 5 on 8 or more exams.
Which
and I will say that this graduating class in 2007, on 17, I anticipate that there's going to be a few more because there are multiple kids who have at least 8 exams, whereas in the past that wasn't so much the case.
Very hard to get the 8 exams.
Yes. Yeah. And it's 2 weeks. I mean, it is jam-packed. I mean, there's a lot going on for them.
Right. I mean, it's hard to do it over the 4 years. You have to be starting in sophomore year.
Yeah.
Really.
For the courses. Right.
Yes.
Right. Right. So the last slide is what now? And so this is where I get to talk about, like, the part that I love. Like, although the data's good, the first one I just want to talk about is the new developmental guidance model. And I feel very fortunate working with Mr. Bacher, who has opened the doors for us to be able to meet with students on a more regular basis. And so this flex block is a baby step in the towards the direction that I want, where counselors have a lot more contact with students. So first quarter, we focused on seniors. Then we go to freshmen, then juniors, then sophomores. So each student will meet with us at a minimum 4 to 5 times. So that's flex block in the groups, as well as the one time that we're meeting with them for scheduling, whereas last year we started meeting with every student to talk about their course selection, which I do think helps with the college admissions process. So that was successful last year. The seniors that we met with this year, so everybody met with their own caseload. So we just split them up into two. So there were 3 sessions that they had. This is the first year that we have met with seniors in groups. In the past, it was just the one-on-one meeting, and then outside of that, it's whatever they needed. So this year, they had the 3 sessions in addition to the individual meeting, and then on top of that, any other questions or any other meetings that they had. What we found, although we haven't, put out a survey to ask the kids specifically, which we will be doing that, and we also want feedback from parents. But just internally, what we were feeling is that more students were owning the process because they had the built-in time during the day that they had us. We had structured lessons, but we also allowed a little bit of free time for them to be working on whatever it is, but it had to be specific to post-high school planning. There are students who are not going off to college, so they had the time to also be looking at other things too. Such a high percentage of our students are going off to college, and it gave them the opportunity to, on one particular day, a senior wanted to work on their Common App, but another one wanted to work on their essay. Like, there was that flexibility with us right there to help answer any questions. We also found that because of the increased contact, we think that more students were actually applying and having parents were more cheerleaders versus actually needing to fill out the application. But what that also did is raise more questions for the students to come and ask us. So I definitely found in my caseload alone, although the increased contact as far as the groups, it also increased the time that they came and they found me afterwards. And that has a lot to do with, I think, the comfort of them meeting with their counselor more regularly. And that was just for seniors, but we are starting with freshmen now. So by the time freshmen are seniors, they have met with us quite a bit, 4 to 5 times every year. So by the time they're seniors, we are really going to be able to help them as opposed to just kind of starting and asking them questions. The goal is for us to really have a good sense of who they are, to be able to help them in their post-high school plans. So we are working with freshmen now. So the model is the topics are the same as in past years, except we're just digging in a little bit deeper. So freshmen, it's the transition to the high school, the goal setting, and a real focus on who they are and who they want to be in high school. Sophomore year, we follow up with what they did freshman year, and then we're doing the career interest inventory because there's 3 sessions. In the past, we just did the career interest inventory and they were just left on their own to look at the information and the parents just looked at it on their own. Can't really say that there was all that much follow-up. Maybe there was, I don't necessarily know, but it will be built into the schedule that we're having conversations with them and digging a little bit deeper into what their findings are. junior year. It's a post-high school planning, and they're doing the college search. They're finding out all the different wonderful things about Naviance, but how to research colleges and other post-high school plans. And then senior year, it's the applications. So far, it has really been wonderful, and to the point where students were asking for more. So I was glad that we were able to put more flex blocks in. And who knows, maybe 5 years from now, my dream will come true where we're actually teaching like quarter-long classes or something. But right now, I'll take flex block. In addition to that, there are a few of us that in our collaborative PLC, we're looking at the standardized test score data. So the trends over the last few years, specifically the SATs, the SAT subject tests, the AP scores, and the ACTs now. And how does that relate to our curriculum? So our group is going to be looking at all the data, also comparing the college admissions data for the Middlesex leagues and their SAT scores and their APs, and then taking that information, bringing that back to department heads, and then figuring out from there where we want to go with that. I definitely found that it was something that I was looking at over the summer, but there's so much information that we need a variety of people looking at this. So our math department head will be joining us along with another math teacher and a few of the guidance counselors. We're going to continue to work with every student on the course selection process, because I do truly believe that this helps with the college admissions. When we have students having conversations with us as far as what their interests are, what they want to do in the future, and we can guide them a little bit. Not only about levels, we can have conversations with them about how they're doing in school, but then also what are the right classes for them, depending on what major they might be interested in. And then the last part, I had talked about the counselors and I were trying to make a conscious effort to the things that are already in place as far as us connecting with the colleges, how can we improve that even more? So the college fair, as I said earlier, we provide a very nice dinner. It's actually one of the, I think, the highlights for the college reps is that they get such a nice dinner and they comment on it every year. I'm definitely not taking that away from them. It's a nice way for them to remember Reading. But having us split up and go to the different tables and really talking to them. In colleges, when they filled out the survey, that's one of the things that they were highlighting as that they liked about the college fair. Not only were the students going and they were having positive conversations with the students and parents, but also that there were staff and a few department heads came to the college fair too and mingled. And they were also able, like Trey Skian was there, as well as Mary Ann Lynn, and specifically asking about science curriculum as well as math. And it's just a great opportunity for them to be getting information to make informed decisions. And then each year we have the around 50 or so colleges that come visit us, and taking the time for each, we rotate which counselors meet with the college reps, but we have our list of questions, and it's just a nice way for us to be connecting with them that way too, so.
The college, are you talking about the one at the Shriners?
At Shriners, yep.
And where is the dinner?
It's at Shriners in their back room.
That's multiple districts. Or is that Middlesex?
Yes, there are 8 districts that go. It's not just Middlesex, but there are 8 districts that participate, mm-hmm. supposedly, in the planning. Reading does the planning. But it's nice because it does draw in a large crowd because of colleges. Because when colleges know that they have 8 districts that are visiting, they're more likely that they're going to want to attend a college fair like that versus just coming to just a single high school.
Data, like the SAT subject test, that's the data for the like last year. It's not, so any students that are taking the subject tests in sophomore year or junior year, it's this year. Is that correct? It's not those students, or is it all of the subject tests that the
all
seniors
of the,
took?
It's all of the subject tests.
Okay, so it is actually all, so that's the subject tests that were taken by last year's seniors in all of the subjects across their 4 years.
For APs or SATs?
No, SATs.
Okay, so SATs, so if like it was biology, then it's really like freshmen who are taking it, so it's not,
That's what I was trying to understand, right. Versus the APs, it's all of the AP exams those seniors took, but the SATs, it's more, it's the year.
Right.
SATs that were taken.
Right. Right.
Okay.
It's very exciting stuff that's going on, and we're very grateful for the work that you're doing. It really sounds like we're putting in some really good, positive structures for the students. And it's very exciting to get the update, so thank you both very, very
much
for being here
tonight.
Thank you for having us. Appreciate all your
time. That was so exciting. Yes, Dr.
I was just going to say, this was really helpful to see how the pieces fit together, how the flex blocks fit together with how you're connecting the student mapping, you're connecting with individual students and groups, and how that's translating into the next steps for them and for the district. It was just really helpful to see how this pulled it together and how your vision, because I think that's what's driving this. It's thank you.
It's nice when the schedule helps.
Yeah.
Instead of being an enemy.
Mm-hmm. It's one of the things that schools just struggle with the most. I mean, you know, just at the meeting that I was at with the Middlesex schools, they were asking me, how are you able to meet so much? And it's because of the change in the schedule.
Yeah.
And they don't have that. So I was glad that he had the vision to do it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you both so much. And happy Thanksgiving.
You too.
Enjoy the holiday.
Not much time to get things ready now.
Exactly. So I don't envy you going after that, Ms. Taft.
Just as exciting?
No, spreadsheets. So we're going to get a quarterly budget update from you. It's my understanding, and we have the memo in our packet.
We have the memo, so I thought I would just highlight some of the items. So I've included in the packet the quarterly update, and this was done as of October 28th, and we will be continuing to refine it as we go throughout the year. We currently have an unencumbered balance of approximately $397,000, and that is reasonable for this time of year, as well as historically where we typically see ourselves at this point. Just to point out, I know at town meeting they did approve the additional fees for the custodial contract. That's not yet reflected in here because they hadn't closed town meeting and then the 7-day period, so that has not yet been reflected in there. That will be reflected in the next update that we provide. We have forecast includes projected salaries, other expenses, as well as any known planned expenditures that we have been included in here. A couple of just some high level items as we go through it. We do have a forecasted surplus within the administrative line item, and that is due to an open position that we currently do not plan to fill. So that is a known item there. The district-wide program cost center, that is comprised of the health services, extracurricular, athletics, and technology, is currently forecasted to have a deficit balance of approximately $18,700. That deficit is the result of some recurring network subscription services, and that is the help desk software, desktop management, server management, and monitoring software that we have put in place over the past year. A lot of those services were put in place after the formation of the budget last year, so they were not included in there. And those are all items that are helping us to manage our overhead costs by providing the services much more through automation. And as we're going through the current budget process, we're actually working with folks to sort of do the bottom up to make sure we are capturing any known recurring licenses and maintenance that we have. So as a result of that, we are requesting that the school committee vote to authorize the transfer of $22,000 from the regular day budget into the district-wide program. And that includes a little bit extra in case there are any other incidental items that come up over the remainder of the year. The school maintenance area is projected to have a surplus, and that is mainly due to staffing, the timing of leaves and terminations and people coming in. We'll continue to monitor that throughout the year, especially if we have to incur any overtime hours to cover for that. So we will be continuing to monitor that.
overall, the regular day forecast is currently at a surplus. You'll notice that there is a significant deficit in the district-wide. That is, as of right now, we have put a placeholder in there to include $150,000 for year two of the science curriculum. As we progress throughout the year, that's an item we're going to continue to monitor, and to the extent we have adequate funding available. We also have included $30,000 for additional K through five curriculum for Joshua Eaton within there. So that is the reason why that one is over budget at this point.
Can I just clarify? Yeah. So is that the 150 plus the 30 plus the 18,767? Is that what's in that number?
That
197.
The 197 includes the 150 and the 30,000, and currently some of the professional development has gone slightly over, so we haven't taken it out of other line items because we still had an overall surplus in there, so for tuition reimbursement and professional development.
I'm just sort of still looking for the 18,76 deficit balance on
the 18 would be the 41.45 for health services, the negative 447 for athletics, 447 for extracurricular, the 1362 for athletics, and the 21103 for technology. It's the sum of those four.
Okay.
It's those four areas combine one cost center for our budget purposes.
Okay. That was not connecting. Thank you.
I should put a sub total.
What's the 30,000 curriculum increase at Eaton?
So one of the things that Gail is referring to is, because we had some savings in hiring this summer, what we're trying to do is put more resources at the Joshua Eaton to help them with some of the areas that they need to work on. So one of the things that we've talked about to you, you've heard in presentations, is that we've gone with a full-time team chair at Joshua Eaton, whereas other schools at the elementary level are half-time. So that's reflected in this projection. The other thing is we're purchasing additional literature materials for each of the classrooms. I think Mr. Martin could probably talk a little bit more about that. That's what the 30,000 is that we're talking about. We're putting things into place so that they can strengthen areas of literacy, which is one of the areas that as a level three school they needed to focus on.
But just to clarify what you just said, the additional team chair I would see under the special needs
section
of
correct.
This, whereas the curriculum materials would be under regular.
Correct.
Okay. Thanks.
I was talking a little bit more broader. Since you asked the question, I expanded it.
That's great. Any other questions from the committee?
The others were, a lot of them were salary savings within the areas. Coolidge, you'll notice, is in a deficit position. That is due to carrying two positions, paying two salaries for, in positions where an individual is on leave and still being paid, in which we have backfilled the position. So that reflects that item. Mrs. Wilson and I meet regularly on the special ed area to make sure we're reviewing where the needs are between the different buildings and making sure where feasible we're reallocating the resources and funding appropriately. We have encumbered all of our known out of district tuitions, as well as our transportation costs, as well as an estimate for some, there will always be unanticipated placements, so we have factored that in as well. And we also always strive to be able to prepay some of next year's tuitions with this year's funding, mm-hmm. which we have been able to do over the past few years. So we're constantly monitoring those items as well to make sure we're allocating the budget dollars where they need to be.
Can I ask a question about the RISE deficit? So that was an additional classroom. Is that being offset at all by tuition from general education students? Or
it's a substantially separate.
That is my question.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's pure cost. Okay. Thank you.
And I'm sorry, I think I missed the Birch Meadow deficit.
The transition of the Connections program, or formerly the DLC program, moved from Barrows to Birch Meadow. This was last year was the last year. So the staff from Barrows moved to Birch Meadow, so you see it sort of offsets.
You notice they're almost identical.
Yeah. So it's an offset of a teacher, you know, teacher and paraprofessional.
Dr. Doxey?
Do we, on the 110-540, the rise, that's for the additional substantially separate classroom, you said? Is that something that we can expect any state help for?
No.
No.
And that fluctuates, as we've talked about with preschool, that's probably our most, one of our unpredictable cost centers, because we don't really know until we evaluate. And then we have to provide services. So that was put in place after April vacation last year.
Yeah, it was right after April vacation.
Due to the number of students who were turning three.
So again,
at that point.
Subsequent to the budget being finalized.
Yeah.
So with respect to the Coolidge deficit at Coolidge, was that unknown?
We have a person that's on medical leave right now.
Okay, and it just was not something that was anticipated when we did the budget?
No. We don't normally budget for those positions, because we're not aware.
Yeah, I guess I didn't know. I mean, I was thinking, a maternity, I don't know whether we do or
this is not a maternity.
Okay, but in those cases, you potentially could.
That's different. This is not a maternity.
Okay, this isn't on it. Yeah, you cannot.
Unanticipated.
Right, okay.
Just on the rise, I can't remember. When did we get the last report on this?
You haven't. This is your first quarterly report.
Okay. So we wouldn't have seen that until now. And this is the first we're hearing about this? Or I can't remember. Maybe we heard about it at a meeting.
We did bring it up to you last, at our final report last year.
Okay.
About the substantially separate program that we had to add.
Okay.
You mean the final report in June, like in June, because you said this.
Yeah, I don't think we did it in June. I think we did it in August.
Okay. But it didn't happen until April-ish.
Right.
Right after April vacation, like the end of April.
please. Move to authorize the transfer of $22,000 from the regular day cost center to the district-wide programs cost center.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Thank you really very much, Ms. Dowd. That was excellent work. All those in favor? 5-0. And now we get to talk about old equipment and furniture.
So within the package that was provided, there was an inventory that was completed, and as you'll notice, we put locations where they were, so you can see that this is relatively old furniture. It's stored in boiler rooms and attics. We completed an inventory, and what we were asking is that the school committee declare it as surplus, after which we will take the necessary steps to proceed with offering it to other areas, disposing it. I will say that most of it, as you can see from the list, is damaged and is not going to have much of a salvage value, but this will really assist us in freeing up space, because this is taking up a considerable amount of storage space to have all of this old, damaged, broken furniture being stored. So that is why, after having completed this, we would like to ask that we declare it a surplus and then proceed with the appropriate steps.
Definitely. Yes.
Move to declare the listed furniture as surplus and authorize.
Each item?
What's that?
He wants to read each item.
I'll go down.
And to authorize disposal as required by Mass General Law Chapter 30B.
Thank you. Was that a second? That's what I heard.
Oh, second.
Okay, great.
I have a question.
Yes.
So, does the money, assuming we don't have to pay someone to take it away, from the disposal come back to the school?
Goes to the general fund. Free cash.
And this, we do not anticipate that this would be any significant source of
From the description, I don't think this is gonna.
Like I said, assuming we don't have to have.
Does it cost us, or is it, do we get, will it cost us money, or will it?
It's a big boiler room.
Well, chair bottom steps.
How about the attic?
It was a fun inventory. We actually would be, there may be slight cost associated with hauling it out.
Yeah.
Of here, but it, rather than necessarily paying to clean it and try to, you know, do that. So we don't anticipate it would be significant. I know some of the chairs, other areas are interested in them, so the town has offered to come pick up some of the items, so, but.
You know, that wooden play boat, could, you don't know, that could be, yeah, that could be.
Would you like that? That could be worth.
Well, and as you said in the motion, the disposal is managed under Mass General Law, so it will be disposed of in the appropriate way.
It will follow through in the appropriate.
I can't believe how much is in Joshua Eaton attic.
I've been hearing quite frequently.
I've been up there, it's a pretty big attic.
Yeah, it is a big attic.
Used to be the superintendent's office.
Yes.
Is there any potential space that might be usable with any of this?
It was actually a special ed classroom too for a while.
The only way you can get up there is through a ladder.
I don't think that would be a good idea.
No.
It was a special ed classroom too for a while.
Yeah.
Any more discussion on Joshua Eaton attic?
Some of the notes are very amusing.
They are. This is a very amusing way to end.
They need screws.
I like the one that says desk rusty.
Yeah.
Great.
All right.
All right, all those in favor of declaring, there we go, 5-0. I think we're done for the evening.
Yes, I have to go start this.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Before we say that, I'll say, happy Thanksgiving to our administrators and to all the staff and parents and kids in Reading.
Thank you.
All those in favor?
We have a lot to be thankful for.
5-0. We're adjourned.